60 Minutes. Rewind.
It usually begins with an emotional domestic breakup, parents fighting over the kids. And then, in the heat of a bitter custody battle, one party charges the other with an unspeakable and frequently unprovable crime, sexually abusing the children. In some cases, no doubt, the allegations are true. In others, a weapon of revenge. It's a story we've done before on 60 Minutes, but this one is different because everyone knows the parents, at least from the movies. The father is Woody Allen, writer, director, actor. The mother is Mia Farrow, his frequent co-star and the mother of his three children, two of them adopted. He is accused right now in the newspapers, perhaps later in a court of law, of abusing their 7-year-old adopted daughter, Dylan. Woody Allen doesn't deny having an affair with 21-year-old Soon-Yi Previn, whom Mia adopted when she was married to conductor Andre Previn. What he does deny is that last August at Farrow's Connecticut country home, in the midst of a bitter but still private custody fight, he molested 7-year-old Dylan.
A gigantic industry has been built on a total non-event. And when I say a total non-event, I mean a total non-event. It wasn't as if, you know, I tickled my daughter or something and much has been exaggerated. I'm saying nothing at all. I mean, I went up and played with the kids, read them stories, did my usual things. We played out on the lawn and had a wonderful time with them. And out of this has grown lawyers and psychologists and district attorneys and private investigators. And I mean, I'm saying it's a multi-million dollar industry that has sprouted up over a total non-event.
It may be a non-event to Woody Allen, but not to Mia Farrow and not to authorities in Connecticut, who are required by law to investigate every reported incident of alleged child abuse. It is that investigation and the attendant publicity that convinced the reclusive Allen to sit down with us in his Manhattan apartment and discuss the situation, no holds barred.
The allegations are that you took Dylan into a attic or crawl space, that you touched her in her private part. Is there any truth to that at all?
Look, be logical about this. I'm 57. Isn't it illogical that I'm going to, at the height of a very bitter, acrimonious custody fight, drive up to Connecticut, where nobody likes me in the house? I'm with a house full of enemies. I mean, Mia was so enraged at me, and she had gotten all the kids to be angry at me, that I'm going to drive up there and suddenly, on visitation, pick this moment in my life to become a child molester. It's just incredible. If I wanted to be a child molester, I had many opportunities in the past. I could have quietly made a custody settlement with Mia in some way and done it in the future. I mean, you know, it's so insane.
Allen is cooperating with the investigation. He's made his own psychiatric files and the files of his children available to authorities. He's submitted to a polygraph and a battery of psychological tests. The reports we were shown would seem to support his contention he's not a child molester. Why then would Allen's 7-year-old daughter tell a Connecticut doctor otherwise?
Either she has been coached methodically to tell the story because...
By Mia?
By Mia, yeah. Because first of all, several weeks before it happened, Mia called me on the phone and said, in the course of an argumentative phone call, she said, "I have something very nasty planned for you." And I said, "What are you going to do, shoot me?"
When did this happen?
This happened several weeks or a month before the allegations.
This was last summer?
Yes, this was a month before this happened. And on many, many occasions, over the phone and in person, Mia had said to me, "You took my daughter and I'm going to take yours."
What did she mean by that?
She meant by it that I had formed a relationship with her 21-year-old daughter, and she was going to get my daughter, who's Dylan, I only have one daughter. That's what she meant. She was going to seek
her
revenge that way, yes.
Because of your affair with Soon-Yi?
Yes, absolutely. You took my daughter, I'm going to take your daughter.
Allen contends that from the moment Mia Farrow discovered the nude pictures he'd taken of Soon-Yi, she considered him morally guilty of child molesting, even though Soon-Yi was legally an adult. A month before the alleged incident with Dylan, Allen says he found this note on a door while he was at Farrow's house for Dylan's birthday. It reads, "Child molester at birthday party. Molded then abused one sister, now focused on youngest sister. Family disgusted."
Mia wrote that note. That's her handwriting.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Allen says he's always been a devoted father, a constant presence in his children's lives. And he's threatened a lawsuit over a recent magazine article that implied he had an unhealthy obsession with Dylan. Not so, according to Allen, who says if Mia Farrow had problems with his behavior towards Dylan, she didn't raise them when it came time for him to adopt her daughter.
She wrote a glowing letter, or an affidavit, saying that I was just a loving and a caring and attentive father, and that I was that my adopting Dylan would be great benefit to her. This was her sworn affidavit.
When did she write it?
She wrote it in December of last year.
A month before things exploded.
Yes. Yes.
A month before she found out about you and Suni.
Yes.
And what was Mia's reaction when she found out about Suni?
What happened was crazy behavior that became, terrible rage, death threats. Look, if this is not irrational to you, I mean, she accused me of child molestation on August 4th, right?
Right.
And that I molested my daughter, I molested my daughter, and August 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, the week after, she's fully saying, when do we begin our new movie? I'm going for my costume fitting next week, and she made an appointment with the costume designer on the movie, and I said, what do you mean the new movie? She said, well, I'm supposed to go in and see the costume designer. I got to get my fitting, and we're going to begin shooting in another 5 weeks. And I said, are you kidding? You're accusing of child molestation, and you think we're going to just go on with the movie?
What did you say to her?
I said, of course this is insane. I mean, I said, I told my lawyer that, they should call her and terminate the contract. And I went out and hired another actress to play the role.
And as time wore on, Allen says the situation did not improve.
The first time, the first days or something, I felt this is completely justifiable. I have turned up in an affair with another woman, and that other woman is her daughter. I started getting phone calls all night long, and death threats, and calling me the devil and evil incarnate, and she ran out and adopted two kids, and suddenly ran out and baptized a number of kids. She was never religious for 60 seconds in all the years I knew her, then suddenly ran out and baptized the kids and told me that she had found God, and now everything was going to be directed toward a richer life and a greater life, and she was at peace and she was forgiving. And 24 hours later, she was threatening my life, threatening to stick my eyes out.
Did she threaten your life?
She threatened my life many times. She called me and threatened my, she's threatened to have me killed and to kill me, and to stick my eyes out, to put my eyes out, to blind me. Because she became obsessed with Greek tragedy and felt that that would be a fitting, vengeance.
Did you take it seriously?
I took it seriously in the middle of the night. When you get a phone call at 4 in the morning saying that you're going to be killed and that your eyes are going to be put out, you get scared because it's the middle of the night and your heart's beating when you answer the line. When it got to be daytime, I felt better, and I'm moving around in New York City. I always feel, I always feel scared anyhow. So this was no worse.
New York.
Context of white supremacy. They say New York City is a frightening place. I have only visited. Nothing more frightening than the system of white supremacy. The Cows, Gus T. Renegade, and for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Thursday, August 26, 2021. So I have been told. This is our book club, part number 4 on Woody Allen's Apropos of Nothing. Before we even go any further, I want to say first, I wrote about Mr. Allen. I think I was posting content related to the book club and the session that we're doing. And someone wrote on social media, I thought Woody Allen is Jewish. That is accurate. I think in the text that we've read thus far, he has described himself as being a Jewish, whatever that means. that's not a racial classification. I believe Sammy Davis Jr. is also so-called Jewish. Racial classification, white, not white. You can be white and also say that you are so-called Jew or Jewish. Do not be confused. The issue we are talking about is Mr. Allen classified as white? I believe the answer definitively, yep. At minimum, he would be a racist suspect. Number two, speaking of social media, we had someone write, and I don't know any of these folks, if they're classified as white, not white, I'm just reporting things were posted on social media around the book club. Number two, we had someone write and ask sarcastically, are you lazy? Are you ignorant? Reporting that Soon Yi Previn is Allen's adopted stepchild. Now, number one, I was going to say, hey, you are jumping ahead of the text. We haven't even got to how Soon Yi Previn, and we're not even going to get there this week, as to how she comes into Woody Allen's life. So stay with the chronology of where we are in the book. But since this has been talked about, and you know, we're talking about accusations that are decades old at this point, Woody Allen marries Mia Farrow. Mia Farrow adopted Soon Yi Previn, and she had adopted some other children as well, prior to marrying Woody Allen. They get married, I believe, generally, the language used, nomenclature, if you marry someone and they have children, adopted or otherwise, biological, you, the person marrying this adopted parent, become what they call it a step-parent. That would be what it is. Now, if you want to parse words and say, well, technically, Soon Yi is not Woody Allen's adopted stepdaughter. Okay, no worries. We can make sure that's specific. Mia Farrow adopted her, not Woody Allen, who married Farrow, Soon Yi, his stepdaughter. All of that to say, one, we'll get to all this in the chronology of the book. I'm sure, well, I hope he talks about all this in detail. That notwithstanding, like, if that's how this is okay, like, you can justify this conduct, parsing it out in that sort of way, that, well, see, he didn't adopt her and all of that. Cool in the gang. I'm just going to keep it real. Even if he had not married Mia Farrow, if he was just kicking it and met Soon Yi at the library, at an Easter egg hunt, I would still be looking at this like, what in the world? Why are you in some sort of sexual arrangement with a female who is 35 years younger than you? The fact that you add in, oh, and you with her stepmother or adopted mother, and I'm like, come on, come on. You can do all that parsing on your own time. We'll get to that part of the text and people can reflect on that and see what they think about it. The audio segment that we started with, that was from 60 Minutes 1992. That's why I said these allegations and everything we're talking about is kind of old. 1992, Woody Allen goes on the program to, I guess, give his side of the story since people are talking about all of this. I thought it was important. Number one, I have not been using the term transracial adoption as we've been discussing all of this. I think that would apply. Two, at the beginning of the segment, Woody Allen, who's in his 50s at the time of this report, he's asked, did you engage in any sexually incorrect behavior with these young children? He answers the question with a question. I always highlight that is like extraordinarily important, particularly if you're talking to a white person about racism or anything else. Child rape, any other really serious subject matter, and they respond to your question with a question. Not answering you, but they come back with a question. And then he says, is it logical that I would do this? Hey, practicing racism, white supremacy is not logical. People don't always do logical things. So even the premise of the question is absurd. I mean, it would be different if he was coming back with a question like, what do you mean, did I rape her? I was there for 30 seconds. Do you think I could rape someone in 30 seconds? I got the GPS and the phone records. Do you? Now, that would be different. That's not what happened, though. Next, he continues. Now, if you've been paying attention to the reading and or maybe if you're a Woody Allen film buff, I think it was Irie in Louisiana. She called in and she talked about the film Mighty Aphrodite, which I have not seen. I'm not a Woody Allen film buff. However, I was reading some of the synopsis for the film, and it mentions Oedipus Rex. I said, oh, wow, that's referenced directly in the text that we've read already. Woody Allen, in that 60 Minutes segment, accused Mia Farrow of having some sort of Greek obsession and wanting to poke his eyes out. That's in Oedipus Rex. Allen's the one who references Oedipus Rex in his written and audiovisual work. Does she have an obsession with Oedipus Rex? Or does Woody Allen have an obsession with Oedipus Rex? Major part of white culture. Lots of people have to read that in school, so maybe lots of people have some sort of obsession with having sex with your mother, killing your father and having sex with your mother. Maybe lots of people have an obsession about that sort of thing, incest and the like. Anywho, the final portion where Allen, he's talking about being fearful in New York, you know, he was afraid that she was going to come and attack him or something of that nature. Yeah, I guess you can always fall back on being fearful in a situation, especially if you are a predator. It seems like that can work pretty well if you're classified as white. Anywho, we will get started again. This text doesn't really have chapters per se, at least the version that I have doesn't have chapters, and they're not being announced in any way in the text that we're reading, so difficult to kind of figure out where we are in the text. Just have to kind of pay attention and listen closely. Session number 4, Woody Allen's Apropos of Nothing, Context of White Supremacy.
So next morning, we serve papers, and I, like a schmuck, raised on Hollywood movies, have fantasies of the two of us in an adversarial lawsuit by day, but best friends over dinner at night. Adam's rib. You'd think it was a little late in life for me to learn that real life is not an MGM production. The tabloid headlines branded Jean and her boyfriend crooks, and neither ever spoke to me again. I wrote Jean a nice note saying, let's leave this as a matter for our lawyers to work out, but we won't clash. We'll remain aloof from conflict throughout. It will be like a Tracy Hepburn movie that will be a unique experience and provide us both with screwball comedy laughs. After all, it's not that we dislike each other. We just have a disagreement over a single issue. And sober men in dark suits will navigate through the shoals while we do the town each night, popping champagne corks and trading sharp banter. There was no answer to my letter. Not only that, I had referred to the New York Post, one of the tabloids, as a rag, and she turned my letter over to them. And did there come a time when you went to court? Yes, and my case was so overwhelming that they folded midstream and settled. One juror told me the jury was prepared on the basis of everything they heard to give me everything I was going for. Looking back on the sheer stupidity of it all, I am still completely bewildered. Everything could have been avoided. My legal fees, her company's legal fees, which were considerable, the public embarrassment of friends winding up in court, her testimony, which was demolished by my lawyers and the press, her boyfriend's perpetual exposure publicly to sensitive business mechanics. It cost them much more than the meager settlement offer we had made them originally. So how could this happen between close friends? I have only two theories, neither brilliant. The first is that while Jean was a lovely person, her boyfriend was not as kosher as I thought. He came from a very successful banking family that had been involved with a number of questionable encounters. Various others had either sued or wanted to sue him, but couldn't afford it. And so much of his energy went into setting up ways to beat the income tax. Conclusion, he was trying to bilk me out of my hard-earned cash. I don't put a lot of faith in that idea, because from spending years with him, I found him compassionate, generous, and a very nice man. My other theory is that Jean and he were making a moral choice and sincerely believed that I was not doing the right thing as a friend by asking for the money, since not every movie of mine made a profit, and the profit from those that had should cover the loss from those that hadn't. They had been generous friends backing my films so I could continue to work with absolute freedom, and here I was, unappreciative, with the nerve to ask for money. Only a moral choice made sense to me for them to stand their ground so irrationally and squander such a deep friendship. Ironically, if you added up what the films cost and what they earned, there was a profit. It was all so bewildering, a lose-lose for everybody. Okay, now back to Life with Louise, or The Agony and the Ecstasy. Let's just say we had ups and downs, breaking up, coming back together, breaking up. Meanwhile, I'm getting better as a comic. I did well on my first shot on the Jack Parr show, but Parr did not like me and thought I was dirty, which I wasn't. He was vile to me until I made it, and then he claimed credit for discovering me and suddenly was my biggest fan. Ed Sullivan also accused me of being dirty. At a run-through of his show, his staff said, "Don't do your actual routine since we're only rehearsing. You can do anything you want and save your real material for tonight when the show goes on the air." So I did some other stuff, not right for his show, but I was never a dirty comic. By today's standards, Lenny Bruce would be tame. If you've ever heard any of my albums, you know I'm right about that. Anyhow, after I get off, Sullivan gets me in my dressing room and starts to berate me mercilessly. He tells me I'm the reason kids burn their draft cards and rages on with apoplectic fury. I'm sitting in a chair, shocked, thinking, should I tell this guy to fuck off and leave? Why not? Do I care about Ed Sullivan and his show? Not in the big picture. After all, the sun will be burning out in 5 billion years, and no one will ever remember. For whatever reason, I hold my tongue, and I swear to you, it was not fear. It was a calculated decision on how to best play the moment. And simple silence seemed the move. Sullivan finishes and exits with steam coming out of his ears. I do the show with the originally intended material, which was totally uncontroversial, got my laughs, and went home. Well, from that day, and for the rest of his life, Sullivan was my greatest fan, supporter, and even friend. He never stopped praising me in his column. He plugged my albums, my Broadway show. He had me back on the show a number of times. Once we found ourselves at a small dinner table at Groucho's house, and he just could not have been nicer and more complimentary. To this day, I can't figure out what happened to the man. Head trauma? Mini stroke? Was he anguished by guilt? Who was he confusing me with? I did Johnny Carson eventually, loved him. I did Merv Griffin, also a lovely guy. Another religious conversion. I'm on Merv Griffin with Henry Morgan, that nasty, cantankerous curmudgeon. He steps on my opening punchline. He goes after me. I try to go to a routine about my childhood. He says, "Don't give me that. I had two parents, too." I said, "Really? What were they?" The audience goes crazy laughing, seeing this monster get nailed by a young comic he'd been persecuting. Morgan shuts up. No goodbyes. A short time later, when I'm struggling out of town with my first poorly written show, Don't Drink the Water, Henry Morgan comes to see it in Philadelphia. Suddenly, he's my best friend. He comes backstage, offers help. He dines with me, sees the show several times, walks the streets with me, tries to help me diagnose which spots are weak, does his best to make meaningful suggestions. Go figure. I'll tell you about the out-of-town nightmare of my first play, a play I wrote in Europe. But first, what was I doing in Europe, you ask? I was a hot comic, doing all the TV shows, even hosted The Tonight Show on a few occasions, replacing Johnny Carson for 2 weeks. I was all over the press, really making it, yet, interestingly, never drawing. I'd kill them on Ed Sullivan and on Johnny Carson. I'd be the talk of the town in every paper, and club owners would book me eagerly. The only problem was, not a lot of people came to see me. In Vegas, I didn't feel in all conscience I could take the enormous salary they were giving me, and tried mightily to give it back. But the bosses at Caesars would not hear of it. Every contemporary of mine cut record albums. Bob Newhart, Shelley Berman, Bill Cosby, Mike and Elaine, Lenny Bruce, Mort Salve, Juan Mita, who did a JFK imitation that was astonishing. They all sold like they were being given away. I recorded an album, three in fact, all sold weekly. Down through the decades, one company after another couldn't believe the prior company couldn't sell a million copies. They blamed it on poor packaging, poor marketing, Phases of the Moon. Some new company would buy the album and reissue it with superb new artwork. I would plug the album on TV, on radio, in press interviews. Still, very modest sales. One fresh new company taking over from the last disillusioned company, full of marketing ideas and jazzy liner notes, only to sink with it in a sea of red ink. The albums were always very well reviewed, to be admired, but not purchased. Meanwhile, I'm making a bundle from these albums, which are not topical and therefore timeless. As I write this in 2019, they are coming out yet again with new packaging. So not an album seller, no huge crowds in the clubs I played, or a concert draw. Then why didn't you quit? I can't. I'm a star. I was white hot. You can imagine the look on the nightclub owner's face when he books me, expecting lines around the block. And by the second night, they're moving around the potted plants to make the room look smaller. Third night, they need more potted plants to make the place look less empty. By the third week, there's no people, just plants. I'm doing my jokes to foliage. Okay, so how did I get to Europe? I'm working. New York. Warren Beatty catches my act. I don't know him, but unbeknownst to me, he talks me up to his sister, Shirley MacLaine. One night at the Blue Angel, she and the legendary agent-turned-producer Charlie Feldman come in to catch me along with the still photographer Sam Shaw. Sam took the famous photo of Marilyn Monroe with her dress blowing up for the 7-Year Itch movie. I didn't know they were there. But a day later, Sam comes up to Jack Rollins' office and says, "Does your boy want to write and maybe be in a movie?" Now, Sam, if you didn't know him, is a rumpled Norfolk jacket guy with cameras slung over his neck, a mustache, bushy hair, and a distracted look. He was described to me as the kind of guy who says, "Here, can you hold this," handing you a camera or a briefcase, and then 4 years later shows up and says, "Do you have that briefcase I gave you?" A true original, but when he came up to the office unannounced and inquired about me doing a movie, Jack and Charlie figured they had a head case on their hands. He then explained that Charles Feldman wanted to do a comedy starring Warren Beatty, and they both wanted me to write it, and I could write myself a part in it. For this, I would receive the princely sum of $40,000. Jack and Charlie played hard to get for about 15 seconds before they said, "When does he start?" The money was never an issue, and Jack would have said yes to that offer for $40. I finally met Warren, who couldn't have been nicer, more supportive, encouraging. He came to see my act on numerous occasions. We walked the streets and talked. We had dinner and got along well. I met Charlie Feldman, a large power in the business, an ex-agent and now producer, who knew every legendary writer, star, and director in Hollywood. He had been a big deal throughout its golden era, and he loved my humor. He was astonished how fast and effectively I could turn it out, and considered me, his words, a beatnik. I was a T-shirt and sneaker guy, but no beatnik. In fact, an Upper East Sider. Anyhow, the Beatty Feldman axis wanted me to write a comedy with many beautiful women in it, set in Paris, so we could all go and have a great time. This is not a bad proposition to be presented with by a major movie star and a big-time producer. I set about doing it, even as I kept working as a comedian. And I told you how I did not even let myself get sidetracked when Oswald shot the president. After a short time, I had finished a scenario. It was not called What's New Pussycat, as that title didn't emerge till Charlie Feldman heard Warren say it to a lady friend over the phone and thought it would make a good title. And so, screenplay under my arm, typed on Crucible Bond, I came before Warren and Feldman at Feldman's hotel suite. I can't remember if I read it to them or if they had read it. It's probably the latter. Feldman thought it was funny, but winced at everything fresh in it and responded best to its few cliches. Warren felt that the lead role that was written for him was not as funny as the small role I had written for myself. He was probably right in the sense the leading man needed to be romantic, believable, adept with women, whereas a minor character like mine could be much broader, sillier, and so more comic. Hearing their verdict on my script and having graduated from the Danny Simon School of Comedy Writing, I, of course, felt utterly confident in my own judgment, but was not in a position to argue. I agreed to have another go at it and felt I would do my best to see if I could improve Warren's part without stepping on his charm. But there was no way I could bring myself to satisfy Feldman by turning the script into a formula Hollywood commercial story. Nevertheless, it was back to my Olympia portable and the rewrite drill. I can't give you the accurate details of what happened over the next months, except that I wrote and played clubs, did TV, and loved, lost, loved, lost, loved Louise. Here's all I remember. Somewhere down the line, Warren dropped out. As I got the story, it was nothing rancorous, but for certain reasons, he had decided not to do the film. By then, I had finished at least one more rewrite, and I was informed the script was being submitted to Peter O'Toole, a huge star, hot off Lawrence of Arabia. I knew him to be a fine actor, but had no idea if he could play comedy. At that point in his life, in my opinion, he could not, although when he got older, he demonstrated he could, so maybe it was just that material. Maybe it was just my Marx Brothers bred dialogue he couldn't execute well. But he loved the script, found it hilarious, and committed immediately. Shortly after, the second big role was gobbled up by Peter Sellers. Sellers was a genius at playing comedy, truly a hilarious man, also white hot, coming off the Pink Panther. The only problem with Sellers was that he was one of those comedians one hears that is so terrific, he is allowed to wield unlimited power. Artistic power in a movie has to reside with the director, not the star, not any star. The director here was a lovely man named Clive Donner, who did not have a great flair for comedy to begin with, but was decent and civil and open for discussion and flexible, and I really liked him. The rub was he was no match for Feldman or the two Peters, who were full of ideas. Sellers was funny, but wrong for this script. Feldman, a hands-on producer, was a weird combination of risk-taking and also a hack. He'd take chances on who he might hire, but then get in their way, or at least in my way. He hired Dick Williams, the brilliant animator, to do the titles, his first movie. He had Vicky Teal and Mia Fonseca-Greaves as the designers, fresh from school, their first movie. He had Burt Bacharach, who wrote the very effective title song, a big hit by Tom Jones. He had me, a total novice to movies. The cast swelled as Feldman signed Ursula Andress, another big name fresh from the first James Bond movie. Romy Schneider was hired, a European star. Finally, in response to my begging, he hired the wonderful Paula Prentice, a fabulous and beautiful comedian. I should say, he interviewed her at my begging, and the second she entered the room, with that face and figure, he handed her the role. My picture was written for Paris. I was flown there, put up in grand style, given a handsome per diem, and kept fidgeting with the script. I flew to London first, my first time abroad. I loved London, but was thrown for a loop when I ordered bacon and eggs, and it came with only one egg. Obviously, the trauma has stayed with me, because I still wake up in the middle of the night screaming, "One egg! Only one egg." In those days, it was not easy to get a good meal in London. Today, the town's full of delicious food. The movie office was in London for whatever reason, and after a week in Jolly Old, we flew to the south of France, and I'm sitting with all these movie people, friends of Charlie Feldman's, like Daryl Zanuck, John Huston, William Holden. And I'm at the Ducat Hotel and gambling at the casino at night. Me, the Schlemiel, who was dragged up the stairs at PS 99 by Miss Reed, the bulldog assistant principal, for trying to exit the building 2 hours early. Then it was off to Paris, and it was love at first sight. I loved everything about that city and still do. When the movie was finished, the two young costume designers, Vicky and Mia, decided to stay on and live and work there. For a fleeting moment, it crossed my mind to do the same, but it would have been tough, since I was an American-speaking comedian, not established in movies, a born New Yorker, and I couldn't bring myself to. Often I have regrets, but my list of regrets in life is so long, I'm not sure I have any more room for another one. Meanwhile, a week later, we are suddenly told we are disembarking for Rome. The picture will be made not in France, but Italy. Rome lives up to the hype. Fabulous, beautiful, the food, the culture, the movie culture. Yet my script had a Gallic flavor, and Rome was the wrong place. Even Feldman would soon see that. But all this uncertainty was beyond me. It had to do with business, with women, with gambling, gambling debts, deals. We were in Rome a month, and with my free hotel and generous per diem, I'm living high off the prosciutto. Of course, my phone bills to Louise more than wiped out every cent I had. I call. We talk. Then maybe a brief silence on her end. The silence creates a sense of insecurity in me, which leads to some fumbling, the need for reaffirmation. Call ends. Must call back 15 minutes later. Maybe it ended a little too coolly for my taste. Just want to call and be reassured she still loves me. Second call. Reassurance does not come. Tone of call degenerates. Too much dead air. Hang up. Half hour later. Just one more call, but don't want to be a nudge. Needy and clinging, an insect. I'll make up a pretext for calling. Hello? Hey, I just had to tell you, I finally saw the Sistine Chapel. Oh, that's nice, she says. Perfectly reasonable, but insufficient enthusiasm. Pause. Silence. Now I'm pressing and lapse into Bob Hope. And how about that ceiling? You had to use very long paintbrushes. No, but I want to say... Nothing. Unfulfilling ending. When the next call is 5 in the morning, New York time, and she's not home, my anxiety level sets off the sprinkler system in the hotel. I know the truth, but sweep it under the rug. Over the next years, the rug will be fully packed, and I will need an industrial-sized carpet to cover the compromises. Finally, the decision is now made by Charles Kenneth Feldman to go back to Paris and do the movie. I'm thrilled. We go back, and locations are chosen by the director and his minions. The art director was Dick Silbert, extremely talented and extremely charming, but I never liked him. He was too much Feldman's man, plus a relentless name-dropper. But you couldn't deny his talent, and he had a fun personality. Shooting began, bringing with it instant chaos. For one thing, every crazy line or notion Peter Sellers came up with was considered gold, whether it fit in or not. Personally, I wasn't crazy about him either. Years later, Paul Mazursky, who directed him, agreed with my take. But no question, he was a truly brilliant, authentically funny comic talent. Meanwhile, my script was being mangled. I knew I was dead when I wrote a scene where the lead character stops an elevator between floors so he can make love to Romy Schneider, while irate pedestrians keep ringing for us. It was meant to be in a busy office building, but since the film was basically a Hollywood project, the elevator they found was so overproduced, so beautiful, so period with lovely curtains and black wrought iron and glass windows, there was nothing funny about making love in it, as it was more beautiful than most bridal suites. I protested, but authors in Hollywood were one step beneath the caterer. Peter O'Toole was a nice man who bought me a first day of shooting gift, an Irish sweater that I still have. He explained that the knit design in those type sweaters were all different, so that if the wearer drowned at sea, his bloated, disfigured body would be recognized by the family knit pattern. From that moment on, I was confident that if I ever fell into the Seine and they fished out my corpse, my mother would be able to identify me and cancel my magazine subscriptions. Still, I couldn't bear the liberties they were taking with my screenplay. Peter O'Toole runs into a cameo crossover by Richard Burton, who visited the set as they'd just done Beckett together, and they circle one another and say, "Hey, don't I know you?" It was supposed to be gut-splittingly hilarious, but I reached for my airsick bag. I was so embarrassed by what I was seeing, I could only grouse impotently. When I viewed the film put together for the first time, I quoted Willie Sutton when he learned Frederick the Angel Tenuto had killed Arnold Schuster for turning Willie in. "This sinks me," Willie said, and Pussycat sank me. And I didn't spare myself. I could see I was pretty nothing. My first film, I didn't know exactly how to command the frame and be funny. I'm up there dressed in a terminally cute hat at a sidewalk cafe, wondering if what I'm doing is scoring. It was no fun, but I did live at the George Sank for months. I met and dined with icons like Jack Lemmon, Orson Welles, the Burtons. Interesting about the Burtons, they were in Paris making The Sandpiper, and I had lunch with them at the studio cafeteria, and these two giant movie stars kept pushing to be funny to impress me with their banter and comedy insults. She'd call him a pockmarked Jew. He'd make some crack about her weight. And they're doing this all for the benefit of me, a total non-entity. I wanted to say, "Hey, you can relax and eat your truffles. I'm truly not worth the effort." But I guess the natural insecurity that dogs all actors and actresses, no matter how big and accomplished, never abates. Another red flag went up from Louise while I was in Paris. Like, I still didn't get she had some issues. Remember, we'd been lovers for a while, lived together on and off, mostly on. So I call her one day, and we're chatting. In the middle of the conversation, she says, "The leaves are starting to turn. You'd love them. You love fall colors." "And what else?" "Oh, my mother committed suicide." "Pardon me?" "She took sleeping pills." "When?" "Oh, last week." "You didn't call me?" "What for?" Now I feel awkward, because what am I going to say? I could have... Could have what? "Gee, I, Fumford, I would assume you would call the person closest to you." "Why? You're in Europe." "Yes, I definitely was in Europe. She had me there. Still, it seems so odd. It happened 6 days ago. Her mother had saved up her prescription pills and overdosed." "Well," I said, "I could have consoled you." But she didn't need consoling. She didn't seem upset. In fact, she seemed relieved this poor, mentally suffering, lonely woman had ended her misery. All I can say is the whole deal resembles no known social interaction I recognize from Avenue J in Brooklyn to Lanz appearing in the work of Margaret Mead. At the time, Lyndon Johnson was running for president against Barry Goldwater. I was part of a group called Americans Abroad for Johnson. Now, I've never been political in my work. I did not consider Bananas political in the slightest. And I was surprised that when I went to Europe to promote it, all the foreign press wanted to talk about, in relation to that silly Just for Laughs movie, was the politics they read into it. Now, I'm certainly into politics as a citizen. I stood on street corners handing out flyers to vote for Adlai Stevenson in the Democratic primary against Jack Kennedy. I campaigned and did shows for George McGovern, for Eugene McCarthy. Watch who I campaigned for and bet the other horse. I have voted Republican only once in my life for John Lindsay, for mayor of New York. But I was never interested in making a political film. Anyhow, here I was, campaigning for Lyndon Johnson by doing my stand-up act in Paris. I think I can safely say I am the only American stand-up comic who played the Eiffel Tower. When Pussycat was completed, I made ready to go home. I bought my mother an alligator bag at Hermes for an ungodly sum. She never used it, but kept it in the vault at the Dime Savings Bank in Brooklyn. Then the news came that instead of going straight home, I would be flown privately to Washington, D.C. to be part of a big inaugural stage show for Lyndon Johnson. It was January 1965. Rudolf Nureyev and Margot Fonteyn were to perform along with Barbara Streisand, Nicholson May, Alfred Hitchcock, Harry Belafonte, Joan Baez, Carol Burnett, Johnny Carson, and me. I flew back on a big plane, and the only three passengers were Nureyev, Margot Fonteyn, and me. I never spoke to them, nor they to me, during the entire trip. We landed at Dulles, were treated like royalty, and we did that show, which was great. Note that among all these creme de la creme performers, three acts had been discovered by Jack Rollins, Belafonte, Nicholson May, and me. I did my moose routine and exited, as Variety used to say, to hefty mitt. It was the only time I met Alfred Hitchcock. We gabbed backstage, and he was charming and funny. He walked out on stage in front of the black-tie multitude and the Lyndon Johnson family, including the president's wife and daughters, and said in that fabulous voice, "I warned you, the birds is coming." I flew back the next day to Manhattan, thinking that after all those months away, I would be hailed the conquering hero. I had just finished my first movie, hobnobbed with my betters in London and Rome, lived 5 months in Paris on the arm, private plane to the nation's capital, show for the president with illustrious colleagues. I get off the shuttle, and as I walk through the airport to get a cab, I see the newsstand, and I see my photo and Johnny Carson side by side, and a banner line the size of the attack on Pearl Harbor. It reads, "Comics in Bad Taste at Inaugural." Apparently, Dorothy Kilgallen, the columnist, was present at the show, and whatever Johnny Carson did offended her taste, and so did my moose routine. Of course, my moose routine wasn't in bad taste, but I guess her Hearst mentality thought it would sell papers. Johnny Carson and I had two different reactions, mine the nerds, and his the mature man. He called me and asked if I'd like to go on his show and respond, as he certainly intended to. I thanked him for the opportunity, but passed. I was too busy saving that copy of the Journal American, as I was convinced that as long as I lived, and no matter how active I would be over the years, I would never again in my lifetime be on the front page of any newspapers. I got that one wrong. The truth is, I was not at all affected by the criticism. But I'm lucky that way. For better or worse, I sort of live in a bubble. I gave up reading about myself decades ago and have no interest in other people's appraisal or analysis of my work. This sounds arrogant, but it's not. I do not consider myself superior or aloof, nor do I have a particular high opinion of my own product. I was taught by Danny Simon to rely on my own judgment, and I don't like to waste precious time on what can easily become a distraction. Friends have often encouraged me to at least treat myself to the enjoyment of once in a while reading some respectable person's high praise, and maybe even in extreme cases, consider responding when attacked. But I have no desire to do either. I guess Johnny Carson had the more understandable attitude. Challenge your assailant, which he did strongly and decisively that night. Was it really worth it to me to engage some dopey yellow journalist and defend not the Constitution of the United States, but my moose routine? I felt if you believed everything you read in the tabloids, you deserved your life. So I'm back living on 79th Street, on again, off again with Louise. What did we fight about? Everything. The subject matter was just a medium for her to hang her rage on. Like, we're on the street, and I can't flag down a cab. What can I do? There were no cabs to be had. I couldn't pull a cab out of the air. Then when my head's turned in the complete other direction, a free taxi whizzes by. She yells. I turn rapidly, but it's too late. So suddenly she's screaming at me like I'm a private on Paris Island. I'm incompetent, a rookie. I'm surprised she doesn't order me to give her 50 push-ups. Naturally, I start getting a little perturbed. Suddenly, she decides the evening's ruined, and she's storming back inside the house. Soon, she'll calm down, and she'll be making me laugh, running her fingers through my hair, and saying my name in that voice that causes the window panes in the room to steam up. Another time we're having dinner with an acquaintance who recites a hard luck story. We'll lend you the $20,000, she says, as an air raid siren goes off in my head. We don't have $20,000 to lend, or even $20,000 to fondle in private. Then I have to get us out of it. So we argue, and I'm left to break the pledge. Oh, there was the time the electricity went off on Christmas morning. After much searching, she gets an electrician willing to come over. He leaves his family in Queens to take the gig. Moments before he shows up, the electricity goes back on. Now he's at the door, and she's saying, "Forget it, we don't need you." He's saying, "But I should be paid for a service call." She's saying, "Paid for what? You didn't do anything." He's saying he traveled over to the house. "Yes," she says with consummate illogic, "but you didn't fix anything." I try and intervene and explain to her it's not his fault that it's a false alarm, but he should get a service call fee. The guy, a nice man, is getting understandably annoyed and threatens to go down to the basement and turn off our electricity unless we pay him. I can take it no longer and can see this will ruin the day. But the man's right. I pay him. He leaves. I'm the object of much derision. The next few hours are spent in contemptuous ignoring of me, and I wait it out, knowing it will pass, and then heaven's prurient little seraph will cool down with her long blonde hair and pout, and we'll make love over our fat Christmas goose and plum pudding, and God bless Tiny Tim and her parnate. Regarding my relationship to Louise, I refer you to Shakespeare's 57th sonnet. He doesn't actually name me in the poem, so I can't sue. About that time, I met another great character, and his name was Michael Saltpeter. But he had long changed it to Max Gordon. Max was a producer during the golden age of Broadway. He was friends with George M. Cohan and lent Eugene O'Neill the money to get married. He had produced wonderful plays like Born Yesterday, Dodsworth, My Sister Eileen, and The Bandwagon, to name a few, not to mention some by my boyhood idol, George S. Kaufman. I was taken by Kaufman at a very young age. When forced to pick a book to read in the library of PS 99, I randomly chose six plays by Kaufman and Hart. I turned by sheer chance to You Can't Take It With You. The stage direction read, "The home of Martin Vanderhoff, just around the corner from Columbia University, but don't go looking for it." That, to me, was an amusing stage direction, and very unlike the dry books prescribed for school kids that turned us all off reading for life. I read the play, and like so many people, the characters and chaos reminded me of my own family. Like the Sycamores, we always seemed to live with aunts, uncles, grandparents, cousins, never just my parents, sister, and me, or, if so, for negligibly short times. I saw Kaufman on TV, where he was a regular on a weekly show, and he was witty in a refreshingly sarcastic way. When he said on the show in December, "Let's make this one show where nobody sings Silent Night," and was instantly off the air forever, he was a hero to me and my group. When the idea was floated years later that I devote myself to playwriting rather than TV or screenplays, the figure of George S. Kaufman loomed large, and while I aspired to do serious plays, I knew that to get started, comedy was my most direct road. Kaufman and the great Morse Hart had written some wonderful comedy shows, and I identified with the more silly-looking partner of the two. I, like GSK, made many sardonic cracks, was pessimistic, and had a low tolerance for publicly exploited sentimentality. When I found out Kaufman's mother's name was Nettie, same as my mother's, it erased all my scientific skepticism, and I felt there was some karma we shared. Now, through a concatenation of random events, I met Max Gordon. Max had retired from the theater, was on the lookout for that great play that would fuel his comeback. Many tried to please him, but he was demanding. He had been used to the best and would not settle for less. I told him my idea for a play, an idea that could easily have come to either Kaufman and Hart, and they would have written it to perfection, light years ahead of the clumsy way I messed it up. But it was my first play, and when I told Max Gordon that a bickering family vacationing in Europe in an Iron Curtain country is mistaken for troublemakers and has to run and seek shelter in an American embassy, he cocked an ear. I spun the tale out of how they couldn't venture out without being arrested and so got on everyone's nerves with their complaints and idiosyncrasies. Max loved it, and he loved me. More important, he loved my nightclub act and thought I wrote the funniest material. We latched on to each other, and I promised to write the play and give it to him. At that time, Charlie Feldman was setting up the movie Casino Royale in London and offered me a small role. My guess was he wanted me handy to hit on me for funny lines if he got into trouble. And he got into trouble, but he did not hit on me. Probably because he was so removed from the business of creativity, he didn't know he was in trouble. Before leaving for London, Louise and I got married. We had been up and back for 8 years and always returned to one another despite the breakups. She and her shrink had discussed it, and the notion arose that maybe the act of marrying, the commitment, would put a totally different and more solid cast on the relationship. We were both willing to give it a try. If any of you out there are thinking of this, I don't recommend it. For us, it was a disaster from Jump Street. I was appearing at the Americana Hotel. We bought a cheap ring at a novelty shop around the corner on Broadway, went upstairs to the suite all the performers were given during their stay, and a judge her father knew married us. The judge said in his little speech that he married a number of couples and not one had ever gotten divorced. Records, of course, are made to be broken. We got off to a bad start because weeks after we married, I had to go to London to appear in what turned out to be one of the worst, dumbest wastes of celluloid in film history, Casino Royale. Louise did not want to come. I would be gone for months. We just tied the knot. She might visit, but essentially, this was a golden opportunity for her to run amok with other men. When I got wind of what was going on, I must say I didn't resist the many delectable temptations in swinging London. Some marriage. Here I was, a young man being paid a handsome salary, put up at a nice apartment, given a healthy per diem, and all on a movie that was so ineptly produced, by the time they got to shooting the scenes I was in, I was already on overtime. At that time, between the cast of Casino Royale, celebrities passing through London, producers, directors, writers, and the cast of The Dirty Dozen, which was filming there and included Charles Bronson, Telly Savalas, John Cassavetes, Lee Marvin, there was heavy gambling. This was right up my alley. Big poker games every night. We'd play in a private room at a joint called A Pair of Shoes. They didn't cut the games, but having all those celebrities around the place was worth it to the boss. We started every night about 9 or 9:30, after a fish dinner at Wheeler's, and played till dawn. The stakes were substantial without being really high. You could win $10,000 or $15,000, which made me feel like a big deal card player, until the following year when I met Joe Cohn in Vegas, a poker player who'd bet $350,000 on a hand. I was a consistent winner because everyone was playing to have a good time, but I was a dedicated shark in the game for profit, not laughs or social niceties. I sat quietly, folding bad hands and playing good ones, and winning every night, while the others drank, laughed, and actually enjoyed themselves. At the casinos, I'd watch Cassavetes and Telly and Charlie Feldman enter, buy 20 grand's worth of chips, lose it in 10 minutes, and request a refill. The actors were hanging paper all over town, and if I'm not mistaken, by picking up the gambling debts of one like John Huston, Feldman was able to get him to do a section of Casino Royale, which I'm sure he wouldn't have otherwise gone near. The Beatles were always around, and Saturday mornings one could stroll on the King's Road, pick up the most adorable birds in their miniskirts. Louise and I talked by phone, but she had no burning desire to be with her new husband. And when the movie wrapped, I told Charlie Jaffe that I'd be just as happy remaining in London, which was a delight, and never returning. This was not a realistic possibility, as I had finished writing a play for Broadway. I called it Don't Drink the Water, and it was a nice try, and you could see the influences, but it was crudely done. When I think back on the various times I spent in London, the time I felt most terribly British was probably when I met the Queen. To a bloke like me, I'd say it was a corker. It was at this knees-up gala in the theater. I remember days before, some bugger who was all mouth and no trousers from Buckingham Palace came to try and teach me the protocols addressing royalty as if I was some damp squib. I remember standing in line next to assorted knobs. I just had a cut of the joint and a pint of bitters, and I was feeling quite chuffed. All set for my little brush with the quality, finally Her Majesty, greeting everybody in the line with each bowing meekly, comes up to me and says, "How do you do?" Well, I panicked and went all collywobbles. Don't know what made me do it, but I knelt and stuck my head forward to be knighted. I think the Queen was surprised, and she gave a look to her footman, or maybe he was a lord or an earl. And I fancied I heard the old girl mutter, "Flush this, Vance." Okay, so it didn't happen exactly that way. But I did meet the lady and loved my summer on the Thames. Upon my return, Louise and I took up where we left off before we'd made this life-changing commitment, which had clearly changed nothing. Sometimes it was great, more often pretty rocky. What's New Pussycat had been a big box office hit. I was told the biggest of any film comedy to its time. The correlation between bad movies and big box office was not yet discovered by physicists. Anyhow, I'm home only a short while when I get a phone call. Some guy had purchased a Japanese movie and asked me if I dub it into a comedy. It's not a comedy, but if we put our voices in when the Japanese actors speak, we can make it funny. Sounded interesting. So I got some pals, including my wife, went into a studio, put the film up on the screen, and ad-libbed the track of this serious adventure movie, making it into a comedy. When I was unavailable to change a few lines, the producer hired someone else to add them. The project turned out not just uninteresting, but dumb. My work on it was not very good, and the added few lines by whoever were embarrassing to me. I sued to get my name off, but when the movie came out with the venal title, "What's Up, Tiger Lily," it was a hit. At that point, wiser heads told me to shut up, withdraw the suit, and go with the flow. I did, but both the What's New and the What's Up movies humiliated me before my mirror, and I vowed that I would never work in movies again unless I had total control, which I've always had since. On the first few movies, I had it because the people who hired me were enlightened men, and they respected directors, and soon after it became a must in my contract. But I once again am going too fast. Interesting sidebar. To show what a confident or maybe pompous ass I was at the time. When Pussycat came out, it deservedly got bad reviews, but did great at the box office. While Pauline Kael found some good things in it, most of the reviews were not raves. "What the hell is this chaos?" was the theme of the critical community. I thought the financial success would ensure I would be able to direct my own movie, but the word was the film was only successful because of the stars, and I was lucky. I noted at that time privately and smugly, someday Pussycat will not be known for anything except that it marked my debut in movies. Can you believe that obnoxious self-importance? In an ironic payoff which does not diminish my revolting contumely at the time, I saw a copy of What's New Pussycat in a video store, and on the box was printed as the big selling point, Woody Allen's first movie. Did it give me any satisfaction? A supercilious smile played across my lips like Professor Moriarty's, though seconds later I was snapped back into the real world where those little ironies failed to justify nature's shabby indifference. Another example of my disgusting self-confidence was when I was 21 and hired by Max Liebman to write on a TV series starring Buddy Hackett and Carol Burnett. Liebman was a very big deal producer of classy early TV shows like Sid Caesar's Your Show of Shows, which in addition to great comedy, featured ballet and classical music. Liebman loved me and loved Buddy Hackett, but the show was ill-fated. I wrote only one half-hour episode of Stanley, as it was called, and one critic wrote that Buddy Hackett could have ad-libbed a funnier show. I cut out the review and saved it with imperious presumption, fully certain it would be ironic in later years.
Context of White Supremacy. End of our first audio segment. Now again, no chapters, at least in the text I have, no chapters. He's not announcing any either in the book, so can't really assist in moving forward other than where we will pick up at. There's a pay or a slight break in text, and it says, "So now we find me home with a freshly written Broadway play, which Max Gordon, a different Max," and blah, blah, blah. But that's where we'll start back up at next audio segment. The number to dial if you have commentary, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Email untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com if you have commentary, questions, thoughts that you would like to share. Let's see. Written commentary, one of our investors wrote in. Let's see. All right. See, greetings, Gus. Number one, in an attempt to recognize patterns, the reference by Alan to David Panic. Oh, that's from last week. Brought to mind Jeffrey Epstein, who was also a school teacher as a young adult. However, he was employed at a posh private Manhattan school, white children, I presume. Shortly after dropping out of college, he was accused of being inappropriate with the teenage high school girls while there and was fired. Why am I not surprised? The Dalton School. That's where Jeffrey Epstein went to school. Jeffrey Epstein, you want to talk about going all the way current? Jeffrey Epstein was also accused of lying about his credentials. I think he got in trouble for that as well at the Dalton School, where he, I think he'd been teaching there for a while. He, you know, was already hired and everything. And then they kind of did, I guess, some checking, as opposed to doing the correct way where you check references and do all your background information before you hire the person. He was hired and had been working there for a while before it was, hey, this guy didn't even go to school here. Deception. Number two, the Yiddish, German, Hebrew slang used by so-called Jews, word that is often used to characterize Woody Allen, is nebbish, which means timid, submissive, and weak-willed. Allen has done much to cultivate this persona through his films, and I think he is also attempting to reinforce this image with this book. However, I think this persona may all be a ruse to hide his underlying manipulative, perverted, and sinister behavior. The early evidence being all the sexual innuendos in the text thus far. I'm going to keep this in mind as we get to the portions regarding Sun Yi. I'll say that before we get to the second audio segment. We haven't even read half of this text yet, so yeah, we'll have to see when all that comes, when he gets to, he's lived such a long time and we're only at like the 60s still. It seems like we've been on the 60s for a long time. We're only at like 1965 too. Like, wow, when are we going to get to Vietnam? Like, or yeah, Sun Yi getting in, like, man. Anyway, we'll get the rest of that there. untiljustice@gmail.com if you have questions, comments, thoughts. Let's see. Folks who dialed in, *61, you have commentary to share. Let's see. Folks spectating for a moment, we'll give them a moment to get their thoughts together. Let's see. I'll share a few notes and then double check with listeners. Let's see. From the first portion of today's reading. Back up a little bit. All righty. Okay. When he's that, now that right there, that'll be a question I have for folks who are reading along. He gives this long, from last week to this week, about how Jean, his, this white woman, Jean, she and her husband had this big falling out over money. They had backed his films financially, and then he goes to get this money for a project and they don't want to give it to him. And so now he's got to take him to court and all this. It goes back and forth. Why is he telling us this story? Remember, this is the one that he went way, I think Mo and Dallas used the metaphor Back to the Future. Like, we hopped in the DeLorean, 30 years wait, like, he pulls Soon-Yi into this. They're married with children. Like, whoa, whoa, whoa. We haven't even met Soon-Yi. Like, in the chronology of where we are, Soon-Yi hasn't even been born. How have we fast-forwarded way into the future to get this anecdote about this lawsuit? Why are you telling us this story? That's just one to think about. He says, talking about Gene's boyfriend, he said he's not as kosher as I thought. He came from a very successful banking family that had been involved with a number of questionable encounters. And he talks about possible tax invasion. That's, you know, part of white cultures. Lots of that. Talking about having to reform tax codes right now because so many whites are not paying their fair share. But what I thought was the hypocrisy. Didn't Woody Allen spend all that time talking about his parents were trafficking and stolen goods, and his dad never saw a gun he didn't like, and his dad knew all these mobsters and gangsters? We haven't even got to the allegations against Woody Allen. We're just talking about his parents. That's what he said. What do you mean comes from a questionable background? Like you didn't? Next. Man, I believe this might be in the word guide. When he keeps talking about dirty, he says, I went on Jacques Parr. These are all like late night shows or entertainment shows from like 50 years ago, maybe even more. He says, I went on Jacques Parr's show, but Jacques Parr did not like me. He thought I was dirty. Ed Sullivan also accused me of being dirty. So I did some other stuff, not right for his show, but I was never a dirty comic. All this, you know, dirty, dirty, dirty. What does that even mean? I know in some, what is it, the language with regards to comedy, they'll say that some comedians, if they use profanity, you might be described as so-called dirty. But that's interesting terminology. I think that might be in the word guide, Mr. Fuller's book. Then he says, anyhow, after I get off, Sullivan gets me in my dressing room and starts to berate me mercilessly. He tells me that I'm the reason kids burn their draft cards and rages on with apoplectic fury. Now, I said, wait a minute, didn't he, Woody Allen, tell us before he gave us this long-winded story about when the draft came up and him being drafted was a prospect? Like, whoa, let me go find a doctor to tell him something, like I'm sick or got the whooping cough or something, the Rona, anything. Like, didn't, remember that? We read that. I said Donald Trump would be on, like, man, Colin Kaepernick in the sky, Woody Allen out here disrespecting our veterans. Let's see. He mentions so many different powerful white people who give him a platform, like they have him on their show or they write columns about him or promote his work. I mean, Woody Allen is white networking and all the benefits that you get from just being classified as white. He will say so-called Jewish, but I mean, that's not a racial classification. Again, just being classified as white. Let's see. I'm thinking this is like Sammy Davis Jr.'s heyday. I'm wondering if he's going to get mentioned. I mean, he's Jewish. Like, mentioned for Sammy Davis Jr. or no? Maybe not. Let's see. Use the word curmudgeon. He says, Henry Morgan, that nasty, cantankerous curmudgeon. I didn't have to look that one up, know what that means. Let's see. So he goes on Ed Sullivan, Johnny Carson, all these folks are hanging out. He does all this name dropping of different folks, mostly white, with the exception of Bill Cosby and Harry Belafonte. I couldn't remember his name from last week, but he gets both of them get mentioned again this week and all the different shows and places where he's hobnobbing. Let's see. Keep in mind, I guess, this book was published in 2020, so it was recently written. I suspect Woody Allen probably met and chatted with Bill Cosby. I mean, he's mentioned him a few times already. I suspect that they've been in the same circle many, many times. And I've heard other people say that Woody Allen referenced Bill Cosby as a friend, whatever that means. I don't know. Maybe he would have said more about Bill Cosby if this book were written before all of the legal issues began with Mr. Cosby. Don't know. Maybe that's not the case. Let's see. Next. Let's see. He talked in, I played the audio segment at the beginning from 60 Minutes, 1992, where he talked about Woody Allen saying, hey, Mia Farrow, maybe she has some sort of obsession with Greek literature and Oedipus Rex, all this eye poking. I said, hey, Woody Allen is mentioning Oedipus Rex in his film Mighty Aphrodite. He's already mentioned it in this text. Maybe he has some sort of obsession with Greek culture. Right there. Meanwhile, a week later, we are suddenly told we are disembarking for Rome. The picture will be made not in France, but Italy. Rome lives up to the hype. Fabulous. A Gaelic flavor. And he goes on to talk about how they need more of a French element to the film. But all of this Greco-Roman exaltation, praise, that something maybe to keep in mind as we move forward with the allegations. Just the thought, Oedipus Rex and the like, having sex with your parents. Just the thought to keep in mind. I thought it was important. He says, of course, my phone bills to Louise more than wiped out every cent I had. I call, we talk. Then maybe a brief silence on her end. The silence creates a sense of insecurity in me, which leads to some fumbling. I thought that was important. Just white genetic annihilation. And I think for someone who is accused of child rape, and needing a sense of control over females, and the theme in his films of sexual intercourse with young ladies, sexually, where one of the films where he's 42, he's actual, the character in the film, he's 42 and the female is 17. These types of themes, at least to me, suggest someone who may be insecure about their masculinity. Maybe I need someone who's younger that I can control more easily, dominate more easily. I'm not capable. I have some sort of insecurities about being in a equal partnership with a woman. He's a white man. I could find a white woman who is age appropriate, and we could have a, you know, equitable, reasonable adult arrangement. No. I think even some of the other folks from before had talked about, man, all these dates that he goes out with ladies. He talks about the tragic absurdity of his dating life, and he talks about how so many of them find any reason. Oh, I gotta, you know, feed the hamster. You know, I gotta water the lawn. Any reason to get away from this Woody Allen guy. Like, get out of here. Yeah, maybe there's a reason for that. And that might also feed those insecurities. White genetic annihilation. Let's see. Next. He says he didn't like this guy, Dick Silbert, the art director, because he was a relentless name dropper. Who does more name dropping than Woody Allen? Every other paragraph, it's about these white people I was hanging out with, Jackie Gleason and Warren Beatty and all that. I mean, every other page, it's name drop. We went to the White House and met Lyndon Johnson and Harry Belafonte and... Next, now this fella has said that he doesn't read. He didn't grow up reading. I'm, you know, just a dunce. I just sit around and watch television. I'm not a smart guy. I'm just an idiot. I'm a schmeal. I'm a klotz, a schmuck, you know, all these different names, self-deprecating all the way. He says, this is a conversation he's having with Louise after he's called her 50,000 times. So he says, and she calls him to let him know that her mother has committed suicide, and to which he's all the way across the country. You're in the other part of the world. What are you going to do? Woody Allen doesn't strike me as a very compassionate person. Like, he doesn't strike me as the person that you would run to be comforted in your time of grief. Like, really? And he's on the other side of the world. What is he going to do? Is he going to stop and fly home? Doubt it. So he's going over all that, and he says, she didn't seem upset, Louise. In fact, she seemed relieved that this poor, mentally suffering, lonely woman had ended her misery. All I can say is the whole deal resembles no known social interaction I recognize from Avenue J in Brooklyn to Lands appearing in the work of Margaret Mead. Now that, I don't know if people have immediate name recognition for Margaret Mead. This is a white woman who's been deceased for some time. I have read Margaret Mead. She's written many books. She's an anthropologist. I take that back. If you are an anthropology major or anthropologist, or you studied anthropology or sociology, you may have had to read some Margaret Mead along the way. She wrote a book with James Baldwin, or it may have been, I think they had a conversation that was transcribed into a book called Rap on Race. And I remember her specifically, not just because I read the book. In that book, she talks about how she was an anthropologist. She went to lots of, that's what the metaphor that he's using. She went to lots of different regions around the globe where, you know, these are folks that don't have contact with white people and are not in contact with all the technology in major cities. So she'll go and study them. They go study every grain of sand. She'll go study them and all that. But in that book, her conversation with Baldwin, she said that she had functioned like a white supremacist in some of these environments. She used that exact term, white supremacist. And this is a white woman. They had this big, long dialogue about racism. In my view, this metaphor is another act of racism. I said before, when he used the term Hiroshima to describe Louise's room, that it looked like, you know, something out of Hiroshima. And I said, in my view, act of white supremacy, racism, just, I got anti-Asian violence in the tag for the program. Slaughter of all of these non-white people is minimized as just a way of calling an area reckless. And it's reckless because white people went here to deliberately destroy these non-white people. Then he comes back in this one and he says that Louise's behavior here, I have no reference for it in any of my memories of what happens in Brooklyn or anything that happens in any of these far away, you know, strange Negro tribes around the planet. Like, get out of here. Like, that sort of tacky racism. And I think a lot of people would probably, if you don't know who Margaret Mead is, it might be difficult to even unpack what he's saying in that metaphor. Let's see. And then we get another one. I was never interested in making a political film. Anyhow, here I was campaigning for Lyndon Johnson, second president he's met, campaigning for Lyndon Johnson by doing my stand-up act in Paris. I think I can safely say I'm the only American stand-up comic who played the Eiffel Tower. Are you serious? Woody Flippin' Allen at the Eiffel Tower? It reminded me, I think Chris Rock was talking about what a amazing comic Woody Allen is. And I think some people read that and were just like, are you serious? Like, really? When did Chris Rock grow up listening to Woody Allen comedy? I know they both got a New York connection, but really? In fact, anybody, give me some Woody Allen stand-up. I don't think he's known for that. I think some people are like, oh, yeah, he did stand. But, I mean, I don't think people are sitting around listening to Woody Allen stand-up the way that they do Dave Chappelle, Richard Pryor, even George Carlson, C.K. Lewis, maybe, if you want to stay on the theme of sexually inappropriate conduct. Bill Cosby, even, if you want to stay on that theme. Let's see. Man, I was so reminded of Neely Fuller Jr. on this one. He says white people will buy things and do all of this killing and slaughtering of non-white people, and it doesn't even matter. They'll stack all this stuff up in a warehouse somewhere and never even use it. He says, Woody Allen, when Pussycat was completed, I was ready to go home. I bought my mother an alligator bag at Hermes for an ungodly sum, and she never used it but kept it in a vault at the Dime Savings Bank in Brooklyn. That sort of thing is all the time. Jewelry and things that, oh my gosh, there were only 5 of these ever made, and we had to travel all the way to Australia to get it, and blah, 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 and ends up at the yard sale for a quarter. All the time. What white people value is practicing racism, white supremacy, all this other stuff. Yeah, yeah. Nice trinkets, they look cute and all that. what remains timelessly valuable? Hiroshima, Nagasaki, Birmingham, bombing black people. That's what this is all about. Racism, white supremacy. Speaking of the metaphors, he says, talking about, again, name dropping all the performers and folks who are with him as a part of this campaign, going to the inaugural presidential inauguration of Lyndon Johnson after he wins, after he had his year taken over for Kennedy. He uses the metaphor creme de la creme, that is in the word God, cream of the crop. That's French, cream of the crop. That's in the word God. White is on top. The dirty blackness is on the bottom. We read about Patty Hearst in Geronimo Pratt's book. I think it might have even came up in the O.J. Simpson trial briefly as one of the trials of the century. Patty Hearst being mentioned again here. Of course, my moose routine wasn't in bad taste, but I guess her Hearst mentality, that's the journalist family, newspapers and all that. Let's see. Next. I'll get in one more and then we'll see if folks have any comments from the phone line. Or two, he mentions the film Dirty Dozen amongst many other films and what have you. Jim Brown was in that one, The Dirty Dozen. And he mentions among many, many other actors, too many to, you know, break down all their films and such. William Holden. Mr. Fuller talks about at least one of William Holden's films, Bridges of Toki Ree. He's in that kind of World War II era. This is kind of coming out of that, where they did a lot of like World War II films. William Holden did quite a few of those. But Bridges of Toki Ree is one. Mr. Fuller will talk about that one all the time. Lessons and what have you. And then he mentioned Dirty Dozen, as I said, Jim Brown. I was in that one. I think Ernest Borgnine is in The Dirty Dozen, too. He's had a really long film career. He's in Key Largo and some other Neely Fuller Jr. favorite films. Let's see. Yeah, I can pause there. Let's see. Mo and Dallas, commentary that you wanted to share on the first portion of the reading or any other folks?
Can I be heard?
Greetings, Mo and Dallas.
Greetings, Gus. Greetings, listeners and callers. Thank you for the program, sir. To the audio segment, when the program initially started, he was questioned, you know, the way in which he answered the question with a question, you know, did you harm the children? And him not saying no and then explaining, you know, him saying, you know, what kind of person do you think I would really go, who would go into a place where I'm unwelcome and do these things in this, a person would do that if they think they can get away with it. Especially like a manipulative individual who's trying to downplay or even discount their manipulative nature. That makes sense. Some people would say he looks like the type to answer questions in that fashion. I'll say that way. And I mean, he did marry his wife's daughter. It's she was a kid too. The way he references his wife being drawn away or unfaithful, and tried to paint himself or characterize himself as a victim, especially with him knowing his actions, and he admitted to it later on in the reading, but he made sure to, you know, she's just, I'm trying and nothing's working and we're just quiet on the phone, and she took a week to tell me her mom died and things like that. When understanding a manipulator like him, like the truth very well could be he was short with her on the phone or didn't call or every time they did talk, he made a reason to get off. You know, it's just he reminds me of a wife in a movie that he may have written, and I'll give an example. Like, take a movie based in the East, on the East Coast, a mobster type gangster movie, if you will, and the wives is usually a scene where there's a group of wives and there's always a wife there, you know, bragging but downplaying the brag, like, oh, this Picasso, but it's fading, you know, or just something like that. He does that a lot, and the way he writes, and I'm saying that aloud because I'm noting the way he structures things and veers off and it's all for naught, like the way he met the queen and how he bowed and, oh, never mind, I'm just joking, but I met her. It's a time wasting, disarming tactic, I feel. And I'm noting it because I want to see how he's going to apply this when trying to explain the situation with Sun Yi. I think a large portion of the pointless anecdotes, the time traveling with the case of his friends, even the way he structured the case, I feel like a lot of that is just to fill space in the book, to maybe even deter people from finishing it because they'd already paid for it if they're reading, you know, if they have it, and or they already had access to it, you know, and they'll just get to page 40 and say, there's nothing in here, and throw it. But it's only interesting in the sense that, well, for me, that he is able to, I understand how he is able to shape things shape narratives. Statements like the way I remember it, which could be like anything after that could be a complete lie. And he does it a lot. It's frustrating to know that people are going to like believe things that he's saying. A personal one, the tone of his voice, the nasalness, the way he's talking through his nostrils. That's another thing that reminds me of the wife in these movies. And I bring that wife up because she's usually like a catalyst for something. You know, she's usually getting the gangster riled up to go commit a murder, the murder that he goes to jail for, or getting her going to get some money to get the things she wants, and then he goes to jail. Yeah. So he seems like that. And a lot of that character is a, you know, I never had much, but I was never money hungry. I tried to turn money away, and somehow I got it all. And at the same time, in his actual mind, that's what he's putting out. But he's really like plotting to sue his friends in 20 years. If some people see that, you know, you didn't allow them to pay you, so the money was confusing, and that makes sense for a person that looks like him. Some people would say. That's all I have. Thank you. I mute my line.
Much obliged, Mo in Dallas. I think that's something to keep in mind for a book that was published in 2020. I suspect he may have known that this documentary was going to be released literally months after this book. So sometime in the near future, may have been a part of the disarming tactic to get this book out, even though we haven't got to the Sun Yi portions of the text yet. But I think it's significant, like just pairing with what Mo said, the amount of self-deprecation in the book that we've read thus far where he does so much. I'm just a dumb white guy. I don't read, and I'm not well informed, and I'm just a schmuck and a schlemiel. Even the anecdote with the queen, like flush this vance and all this, just talking down and talking down. And I oozed all of this unworthy self-confidence. And who is this guy? And other than the athlete, I think that's kind of the only time where he's like, yeah, I could play. I could play. And people doubted me there. Like even the people like Mo and all saying they didn't think I was a ball player. And man, I could go out there and get that glove and do nothing. Like so much of this is I'm just a dumb, ignorant, klutz, stupid white guy. And I recoil at that all the time. About the conclusion is that white people in general, or even a specific white person, this is just ignorance. Like, all of that. This book coming out in 2020, for me to just think, oh man, this Woody Allen is just, what an idiot. He's so stupid. And then so much of this, he's the victim. He's not the perpetrator. His friends are stealing from him, and his wife is cheating on him. And even when things are going well with his wife, she wants to go be, you know, sexually deviant and have sex in public. What do you mean? We're having dinner. Are you serious? This is crazy. What? And he uses the word, I succumb. Not I'm a grown adult white man and I decide to go do that. No. She just twisted my arm and I just didn't know. I just had to do it. She just forced it on me. It's so much of that sort of tone. I mean, that's been a dominant tone throughout the text. Just to see now, is that gonna continue? Oh my God, I've even heard it. Keep that in mind what I just said when we get to Sun Yi. That tone, it's in his movies, even the scene in Manhattan. He's in bed, and this is Woody Allen wrote this, and he's in the film. So he's Woody in bed with this 17-year-old white woman. She's the one saying, let's do some sexually promiscuous things. Let's do it in a position that you've never tried. Same thing. What? Really? Blushing. I never. What are you talking about? Is this serious? Why is that pattern consistent? He's the victim, and or someone else is the actor. He's the one that's being coerced. He's the one that has to be dragged into this, especially if it's something sexually deviant. Pattern, pen, highlight, boldface, print. When we get to Sun Yi, remember what I just said. I will remind you of what I just said when we get to the part where Sun Yi pops up in the book. The portion where he talks about the portion where he talks about Tiger Lily, the movie. I've not seen this film, not a Woody Allen film buff. What's Up Tiger Lily, where he takes this serious Asian film and they, I guess, dub over it. The film is called The Key of Keys. It's supposed to be like some sort of serious, I guess, spy type film. And so they take it and they just put English dub over it to make it into some sort of comedy. In my view, that is like massive act of white supremacy racism. I don't think it would be much argument to have some white people take a foreign film, a so-called Asian film, and we're just going to take something that was serious and dub over it to just make it something goofy. Textbook white supremacy racism. Again, I haven't seen the film, but let me see. And then even within that, he does it. Has the audacity to say, hey, they added somebody else to the project and he added some lines I didn't like. This is ridiculous. Take my name off of it. What? Oh, wait a minute. This is a box office hit? Let's withdraw the suit. What? And again, it's the same thing. Like, oh, man, I got my name tied to this raggedy project and I don't like it. And they added to it and it's not even that. Oh, well. And then he adds to it with his the arrogance. He adds to it, you know, one day, the only thing that this film will be known for is I got my film debut with this film. And then he can say, yeah, I was right. Yeah. Incidentally, I'm just reading one of the reviews from this film. Their concluding paragraph reads, talking about What's Up Tiger Lily. This is the film in which we see Alan with angst in his pants. It's no wonder, what does that mean? It's no wonder that the sophisticated filmmaker holds this adolescent, politically incorrect, blatantly racist, sexist, sloppy, and dated entry in such contempt. It may be an embarrassment for Alan, but the rest of us will be losing our stitches. They seem to think that there's some sort of comedy preserved in all of this. I haven't seen it. Maybe I'm missing out. But I just, for that sort of, even for Woody Allen, like, you directed this film. What do you mean you're embarrassed? Stand by your work. You got paid for it. You could have finished your loss. I mean, hey, you aren't about money. Isn't that what he said? When he was giving all of his money, he was making his films to Jean, his white woman friend, and her husband. He was giving all this. I'm not about the money. I'm about making films, quality work and all that. So go through with the lawsuit. I don't even want my name on it. This is ridiculous. Nah, I'm going to just take the money and then I can, what did they say? I say we shouldn't use that. They would say throwing shade on it. Ah, it's adolescent and I didn't have control over it. It's silly. And Incidentally, like last week, I think the caller who wrote in mentioned David Panic. This is the white guy who was teaching, and Woody Allen called him a racist, like flagrantly said, this is a racist white guy, doesn't like black people, he mocks them, and he teaches. He said he had was teaching in Harlem, can't believe it, how did they like him? He goes here and teaches. Now, he didn't say black people, I just had to do the math. He's teaching in Harlem in the 1960s, he's probably teaching black children, and then for you to say, I can't believe they like this guy, he's such a racist. He's teaching black children. So that was last week. He's going to have more commentary about his observations on racism this week. So just be alert for that in the second audio. Any other thoughts, comments that folks want to share as we continue? Any other patterns that have stood out in the reading thus far? Or any questions? Right on. Assume folks are good for the first portion of the reading. We should have time once we get done with the second portion of the reading for questions, thoughts, comments. Again, man, oh man, this is not in my top 10, but I can't exactly say I am bored or disinterested. Like, one, I'm waiting for when it's the sexual point, but I mean, it's so many. Just paying attention to the way that the book is structured, what he talks about, the patterns that I'm seeing that are already pulling up. The major one being he's so ignorant and inept, except at playing baseball. And then the projecting to females and other. Even when he talks about the affair with Louise, he says, he puts the math together that she's been running around and cheating on him while he's away. So that justifies him going out and doing the same thing as opposed to let's get a divorce. Nah. I'm going to go out and I can run around. Not that I was doing this beforehand or not that I thought about doing this beforehand with his obsession with girls that he has in the text. No. He doesn't do any of that until she's been doing it. And he said he swept all this under the rug and he's put up with all this. Now, I'll go ahead and be unfaithful too. But you made me do this. Just something to ponder on. Keep that as we get closer to where Sunyi. I don't think it will be this week either. I think he's talking about other things in his film career. I think it takes some more time for Sunyi to come in the picture. We're still in the early 60s, so I think we're about 10 years before all that happens. We will continue. Again, this is Woody Allen's Apropos of Nothing, audio segment number 2, Context of White Supremacy.
So, Now we find me home with a freshly written Broadway play, which Max Gordon, a different Max, was champing at the bit to read. And there came a time when I gave it to him. Max was justifiably disappointed. A very solid comedy idea was poorly written. It was packed with funny lines and comic ideas, but the construction and attention to detail was amateurish. Of course, I couldn't see this, as it read so amusingly to me, and I thought it indeed followed all the kind of structural odds and ends I'd picked up from reading the plays of Kaufman and Hart. Max, trying to be helpful, arranged to have the play read by Russell Krauss, an accomplished playwright and writing partner of Howard Lindsay's, with whom he'd written Broadway's longest-running play to date, Life with Father. Krauss was kind and encouraging, and he tried to point out the flaws and how I might consider fixing them. I tried ineptly and deluded myself into thinking I had improved the script, and perhaps I did a bit, but not enough. Max's old eagle eye spotted the unfixed flaws the minute he read it and began losing interest in the show and me as the next GSK he had hoped to discover. I believed there was something there, and despite any criticism, it was funny. I wasn't perceptive enough to see beyond the laughs, and that the characters were not dimensional enough to elicit real engagement, and the plot was full of clunky writing. Ignoramus that I was, I sent the play to David Merrick, who instantly found it hilarious and wanted to produce it. I wrote Max off as a producer past the heyday of the blood and threw in my lot with a producer whose presence in the room was always accompanied by the smell of burning sulfur. I insisted to Merrick that we hire Bob Sinclair as the director. He had been Max's suggestion, and since I had spoken with him about the project and out of loyalty to what I felt was a commitment, I had Merrick hire him. This was the second of Merrick's many mistakes. The first was Merrick's decision to produce the play at all. The play had a large cast, and Sinclair, Merrick, and I cast it in the standard way, sitting in an empty theater while actors walked out on a bare stage and read scenes with the stage manager. For the male lead, Merrick suggested I go see Barefoot in the Park with an actor who had taken over when Robert Redford had left. Merrick found Redford's replacement funny and an ideal Broadway romantic comedy leading man. This was how I met Tony Roberts, whom I would work with a number of times and remain friendly with down through the years. He was, as Merrick said, an ideal romantic comedy leading man, attractive in a schnooky way, wonderful with comic lines, and easy to work with. He was a ladies' man. And later, when we acted together in Play It Again, Sam, he once left me on stage sputtering when he failed to enter on cue because he was hitting on one of the actresses in her dressing room. Trooper that I am, I froze and lapsed into Esperanto. Fortunately, a less panicky actress stepped up, took charge, and brought the play back into focus. Anyhow, Tony was a great find for Don't Drink the Water. So was the truly hilarious Dick Libertini, a uniquely gifted comedy actor who played the priest. Decades later, he appeared in another one actor of mine and played a rabbi and killed the audience both times. Our set designer was Joe Melzina, a Broadway icon who designed, under the misguidance of director Sinclair, a huge cavernous set that was oppressive and the opposite of what you want for comedy. Mind you, it was great set designing, but he had been pushed in the wrong direction. According to Max Gordon, the director, Bob Sinclair, had been an assistant to George S. Kaufman, which resonated with me, but in actual fact meant nothing. He had retired ages ago, was living in Santa Barbara, hadn't directed in years, and enjoyed an occasional belt of the grape. He was, as his replacement Stanley Prager said, an enemy of humor. Rehearsals began, and there was much mutual masturbation, with everyone laughing uproariously at everyone else's lines and behavior. The lead was played by Lou Jacoby, a genuinely funny man who had been great in Neil Simon's first play, Come Blow Your Horn. During rehearsals, Tony Roberts and I were always reduced to helpless laughter by Lou, on stage or off. Casting his wife was a Merrick inspiration. I had written it for a wisecracking New York type, actually for the actress Betty Walker, whom I didn't know personally but loved. Instead, with an eye to the box office, Merrick chose Vivian Vance, who played Ethel Mertz on the I Love Lucy show. She was a fine comedy actress, but dead wrong for the role, and she proved to be a huge pain in the neck. The show came to life when she was replaced by Kay Medford, who, like Betty Walker, could make the dialogue sing. But the real trouble was not yet upon us. We were going very strong in rehearsal, and I was told word on the street was very positive. The run-through was effective, the dress rehearsal just fine. We opened at the Walnut Theater in Philadelphia. Ironically, a few blocks away, the musical Breakfast at Tiffany's was trying out. The director, Abe Burrows. Anyhow, we opened and died. The reviews were very bad. Merrick sprung into action immediately and fired Bob Sinclair, whom he correctly never wanted in the first place. He asked me to take over the direction for a few days till he could get someone else. I did, and I stayed up nights rewriting. The cast amazed me. I'd give them new lines 2 hours before the matinee, and they swapped them for the old and put them in right away. The only pill, as I said, was Vivian Vance. On stage, with all the cast present receiving their changes, she complained loud and long about her not getting more to do, more funny lines, more comic business, which she claimed to be a master at from years on the Lucille Ball show. She was talented and a good comic player, but struggled by being miscast. She couldn't get with the idea that the changes in the show are not about her role, but about the plot in general, all the characters, all the lines that didn't play, the structure, the narrative. She remained a thorn in the side of the production until Merrick finally bounced her and hired Kay Medford. Amazing what a difference the right casting makes. Stanley Prager joined us and took over the directing. Interesting thing, although he was no great comic director, he was a droll little guy, good-natured, brimming with energy and confidence, and he immediately made us all feel better and optimistic. He changed the set around and brought the action downstage near the audience as he whipped the cast into shape. One replacement followed another until Don't Drink the Water had the most cast replacements of any non-musical show to its time. Playing Philly was Grimsville, first because of our notices we were playing to not even half houses. Depressing. Then I was pounding out changes long into the night, handing them to the actors the next morning, seeing them scramble to insert them, a miracle of memory and adjustment. But there was one big hitch. The new material often did not match the old material, as more changes were required to keep the plot and characters consistent, so the actors could be playing some of the old show with its now obsolete scenes and characters, and the new scenes, which required different setups in the earlier scenes. What I'm saying is, we were playing two different plots at once, and the two had not yet been smoothed out. The poor audience, stuck with seats to a turkey to begin with, were guinea pigs to our constant fiddling and experiments. Actors and actresses came and went, scenes shifted, were dropped, new twists with no antecedent exposition showed up. David Merrick said to me one late night as I rewrote and labored in my hotel room, "You're really up to your ass in show business." But he never flinched. He stood by me, kept the show running. The thing about David was that he could be wonderful, witty, charming, and a great producer, unless you got into a quarrel with him. I spent Sunday afternoons in Philly with him, watching football on TV. I liked him. He had been a lawyer who went into the theater to meet girls. His words. I did quarrel with him just once over a line of dialogue, which must have been pretty nothing because I can't remember it. Unlike in film or TV, where the writer has the same rights as an Indonesian female, the theater union says not a single word could be changed without the writer's okay. I stood on my rights as author, demanding we insert my new line. Merrick said, "If that line plays tonight, I fire the director." I glanced over to poor Stanley Prager, who deserved the opposite of being fired. He deserved a bonus, and folded my tent. But I liked Merrick. And as the show left Philadelphia and opened in Boston, it was hugely improved. We weren't doing the business of Breakfast and Tiffany's or another show that was reportedly wonderful, but we were coming together. A new scene here, an idea by Stanley Prager there, actors feeling more secure as the changes dwindled, a few hints to me backstage by Elliot Norton, the very nice Boston critic, used to seeing shows as works in progress, and the show was gelling a bit. Let me say, it was playing better and better. It was still not much of a show, but between the fabulous comic cast and my never-ending substitution of new jokes till the line worked, it became a laugh machine. When we got to New York and previewed in the Marasco, the house crew of the theater said they never heard so much laughter from an audience, and that was what made us run 2 years. Not the quality of the play, not the reviews, which were at kindest mixed, but if you were an audience member not critical of a playwright's stagecraft, you paid your $10 and laughed all night. A pleasant surprise I got was that Harold Klerman, an icon of the group theater, who was part of the Actor's Studio and reviewed, wrote well of my show. He saw virtues in it apart from just jokes or the cartoon comic characters. I don't think there are any virtues, but his appreciation of it meant a great deal to me because I've always said I was born too late for the group theater, but would have fit in with them. I sometimes feel I'm a frustrated 30s playwright, out of time, having missed the boat, too late with my offering. But Ilya Kazan liked my movies, and that made me feel good. That would have been the crowd I really saw myself with. O'Neill, Clifford Odets, on through Arthur Miller, then Tennessee Williams. I didn't have their talent, but if they needed someone to get coffee. The morning after opening night, amidst the mixed reception with the all-important Times not very good, Merrick called me into his office. Red-flocked wallpaper. He sat there satanically. All that was missing was that his assistants had no pitchforks. He said there was some action at the box office, and we would stay open and see how word of mouth treated us. But more important, he said, I want to be your producer. I want to produce your hits and your flops. A very nice thing to hear under the duress of weak notices. In time, I would give him my next play, a better one, though still no great shakes, Play It Again, Sam. But that morning, in the heart of the theater district, I was taken with how supportive he was. We took out a full-page quote ad, utilizing every kind word, no matter how obscure the critic. To beef up the page, I used my mother in amongst the many legit quotes, and it was high praise from Nettie Konigsberg indeed. And it came to pass that word of mouth was good, and we ran nearly 2 years, and it was sold to the movies and made into a truly dreadful film. Not by me. And huge out-of-town successes like Breakfast at Tiffany's flopped very quickly, and such is the irony and unpredictability of the theater. Many years later, someone broke into Bob Sinclair, the original director's home in Santa Barbara, and murdered him. I'm told David Merrick had an airtight alibi and can prove he was with friends that night. Tony Roberts and I did not get close that first show. That came when we appeared together in Play It Again, Sam. I wrote that in a hotel room in Chicago while I was doing an act at Mr. Kelly's. As I typed the stage directions and I searched to describe this little film critic's room, I wrote, on the wall is a large blow-up of Humphrey Bogart. I only picked Bogart because there was a popular poster of him selling around at that time. It was logical then, having the movie fantasies, that Bogart would be in one. And I conveniently used him over and over as I wrote, and he became a major character in the story. I wrote and rewrote in that Chicago hotel room. I ate ribs with my friends John and Jean Demanion. In those days, Chicago had a joint called the Black Angus that had ribs, the taste of which gave like meaning you couldn't get from religion, psychoanalysis, or great art. At that age, I ate ribs, could knock off racks of them. Then I'd do 2 shows at Mr. Kelly's, and then late at night go back and knock off more ribs. Today, if I allow myself anything pleasurable, a bell goes off in my cardiologist's office, and I'm put under house arrest. Gene, John, and I hung out sometimes at Hugh Hefner's. Not much, but now and then. It was an open house, nearly 24 hours, hung with Picassos and full of celebrities, sports figures, sexy women. The sexy women were the whole draw. Believe me, it wasn't the Picassos. Anytime I hit Chicago, I got a call from the Playboy Mansion inviting me to stay there as a guest. I never did, But we dropped in now and then and socialized. I have a cardinal rule in life, never be anyone's house guest, and I never hit on any of Hefner's housemates. The thought of any of those stacked miracles wasting a quark of their attention on one more aptly cast as a bumbler freighted with giving the exposition rendered me timid. Over the years, I have had brief dalliances with centerfolds, but it never came about from going to Hefner's mansion. Usually I was mistaken for someone else. I liked Hefner, and I remember one night he explained to me it had always been his dream as a kid to have a house that was going all the time, and you never paid any attention to the clock. You woke when you liked, ate breakfast when you wanted, did what you wanted, no matter when. If you rose at 2 a.m., your day began there, and your schedule worked accordingly to your own time. It meant nothing to me, as other guys' dreams never do, but if it made Hefner happy to live life like that, and it did, great. All I know is he was a friendly and generous host, rich, successful, and if he enjoyed rising at 11 at night, having breakfast, and then playing Monopoly with celebrities, who am I to gainsay him? Things were going quite poorly in my marriage, as Louise had discovered what is today called weed. Then it was grass. In the distant past, it was muggles. Satan also weighed in with uppers, amyl nitrate, quaaludes, and a cluster of new positions to try out with any male registered to vote in the tri-state area. I still adored her and found her philandering typical Louise, but it made for a failing marriage, and we began talking about chopping up the trunk, which is show business for breaking up the act. She had made many contributions to my life, among them urging me to submit a piece I wrote to the New Yorker magazine. When it came to prose, I lacked confidence, certain of receiving a rejection slip, but she felt otherwise. She was right, and because of her instinct and faith, I became a regular contributor to a magazine I had idolized my entire life, and I was fortunate enough to have Roger Angel as my editor through the decades. But no question, she was a handful on assorted pharmaceuticals. Help. What happened next to distract me was an idea popped into my head to do a comedy film documentary style. This had not been done before, and my original idea was to do it dead real, which I did not do, and I'll tell you why, but I did finally achieve it years later with Zelig. Take the Money and Run was a script I wrote with my old school friend and baseball team pal, Mickey Rose. Our friendship went back to Midwood High, where we both dreamed of being in the big leagues, and got out on the baseball field in the summer, no matter how sweltering the heat, and hit baseballs and shagged flies and fielded ground balls, stopping only to stroll to the corner candy store every few hours for chocolate malteds. Mickey had no discipline, but a lunatic sense of humor, totally original. His idea of a joke would be to go to all these show business meetings up at offices with agents and managers in New York, and always secretly leave a can of tuna fish somewhere. He could cause himself hysterical laughter, imagining the businessmen getting together for lunch and one saying, "Funny thing happened the other day, I found a can of tuna fish in my desk drawer." "What a coincidence," says the second man. "I found one on my chair." "Me too," says the third. By now, Mickey is rolling on the floor, tears coming down his cheeks. Years later, when I hired a chauffeur, Mickey wanted me to have the chauffeur drive me every night at 8:15 to Park Avenue and 83rd Street. He wanted me to get out of the car, kiss the lamppost, get back in, and resume life. Again, he'd become crippled with laughter, imagining the newly hired chauffeur telling his wife or friend, "Every night at 8:15, the guy has me driving to 83rd and Park, he gets out and kisses the lamppost, and we drive off." In some interplanetary way, Mickey was a genius. Anyhow, we wrote Take the Money and Run together, but since I wanted to direct it, there were no takers. Then, because my professional life was blessed, a new movie company formed called Palomar Pictures. And being new and having hip guys at the helm, like Edgar Sherrick and Paul Lazarus III, they were willing to take a chance on a first-time director. Now, I did have a track record as an author of What's New Pussycat, junk, but a big hit, and also don't drink the water, more junk, but successful. At least they knew I wasn't a serial killer or someone who'd take their budget, pocket it, and fly off to the Cayman Islands. Putting a watchdog on the film, Sidney Glaser, they gave me $1 million. And here's, as they say, the beauty part. Though it wasn't in my contract, they trusted me to have total artistic control and never once bothered me for a second. I shot in San Francisco, a town that has always been lucky for me down through the ages. The Herb Ross movie of Play It Again, Sam was shot there. So was Take the Money and Run, and later Blue Jasmine. All did well. And I did well as a comic at The Hungry Eye, and I got started as a jazz player at Earthquake Magoons. My leading lady was Janet Margolin, a beautiful girl from Central Park West and co-star of David and Lisa. Much of the cast were local San Franciscans, and they were wonderful. Plus, there were some Hollywood character actors. I kept within the $1 million budget and finished on time. The first day of shooting was to be in San Quentin prison. All my excitement was over the fact I was going into a prison and there'd be felons and I'd see an iconic big house I'd only read about or saw versions of in old black and white movies. I couldn't have cared less that I was debuting as a director. It was the prison I was fascinated by. We were warned by the warden that the population was dangerous, and if there was a riot or any of us were taken hostage, they would do all in their power to get us out, short of releasing any convicts. I found it interesting that when the hundreds of inmates congregated in the big open yard, all the white prisoners stayed together on one side, and all the black prisoners kept together on the other. Not unlike what you might have found in any American college cafeteria, I later quipped on TV to moonscape silence. So I entered San Quentin and began my career staging a riot in a prison yard. Convicts were cooperative and we yelled action, and the guys put on a real free-for-all riot. When I yelled cut and they dispersed, I remember picking up a shiv from the yard floor. Now remember, I stepped on the set never having made a film, knowing nothing of cameras, lenses, lighting, or directing. I had never studied acting. One of the executives from Palomar asked me, "How do you feel being given $1 million to direct a movie?" A million then was a lot bigger number than today. "Nervous," he queried, trying to put me at ease with the same kind of grin Ming the Merciless wore when he had Flash Gordon submerged in lava. The truth was, I couldn't imagine what he was talking about. Why would I be nervous? The whole deal seemed to me common sense. I wrote the script. I know what it is I want to see. I know when I look through the camera if I'm seeing what I envision. If not, I correct things. Maybe I need to move the camera a bit left or right, a bit closer or further. If the character I'm filming walks someplace, we follow him because the camera's on wheels. You know, a stand-in is doing my part, and when the cameraman is finished lighting, we're ready to shoot. I tell the stand-in he can go get a beer, and I take his place. I do the scene I have written and say it the way I want to hear it. The camera rolls, and I yell, "Okay, got it?" If I'm not happy with something, I do it again. This is not rocket science, and the fact that I've never done it before means nothing. As long as you're dealing with comedy, particularly broad comedy, all you want is the scene should be loud, lit, and fast. Speed is the comedy director's best friend. Laughs are what you're going for, and if you have some flair for tickling risibles and you put your wares up on the screen clearly and give an audience a chance to see and hear the punchlines, you're well on your way. Shooting Take the Money and Run went smoothly, and Mickey and I had a lot of fun improvising gags and bits. Back in New York, I cut it together, and I hired this young kid, Marvin Hamlisch, to score it. I asked for a few melancholy pieces, influenced as I was by Chaplin's films. Hamlisch obliged and got to work on the score. Meanwhile, we tested the movie. Here, my inexperience took a toll. I put no temporary music in it, so the whole film is coldly silent. When no one talks, and let's say someone is walking a distance without music, the walk takes forever on the screen. Plus, as we pick to test screen it, the USO, grabbing on-leave servicemen off the street, filling half a screening room some afternoon, and with no rough-cut speech, we naturally die like the Valentine's Day Massacre. Palomar had the same reaction to the film when we screened for them. Even with the addition of some Marvin Hamlisch music, they saw a million garbanzo beans swirling concentrically down the toilet bowl, having put their faith in a fumbling maladroit. They suggested I bring in Ralph Rosenblum, who had saved a number of movies by recutting them, to help me. On the verge of a disaster, I was looking for help from anywhere I could get it. Enter Rosenblum, a sardonic, highly gifted editor, who turned my movie from a failure to success, and here's how. Like Stanley Prager coming in to help Don't Drink the Water, Ralph immediately buoyed my spirits. First thing he did was take all the funny stuff I had cut out and put it back in. He explained that with no music and to a group of lonely, homesick GIs who wandered into a half-empty screening room, of course the film will die. He stuck in some Hubie Blake jazz in place of Hamlisch's lovely but sad background music. And the mere switch from slower music or no music to lively jazz transformed it, or should I say transmogrified it, because the change was magical. He also put some material before the opening credits, which helped speed up the narrative. Here's how I'd sum it up. Ralph really only changed about 20% of the original cut, which he liked much more than I did. But that 20% made the difference between the film working and not working. Without him, the project would have sunk. Anyhow, the film opened in a tiny theater on 3rd Avenue called the 68th Street Playhouse. There was a tree in front of it, and its branches obscured the marquee. My father volunteered to come with friends in the middle of the night and cut the tree down. Offer declined. The film was a critical and finally a box office success, and that's how I got into making movies. Hard work, some talent, much luck, major contributions from others. And in the midst of all that, there came a day Louise and I decided to divorce. And her father, a mensch to the end, brokered a split that was fair to both of us, and we parted great friends. We have always remained great and loyal friends. Anecdote. We went to Juarez to get our divorce after sleeping together the night before in San Antonio, and we were so lovey-dovey in the waiting room with others waiting to divorce that a man asked us, which of you is getting the divorce? We said we both were, from each other. He couldn't believe it, that two people so openly loving were splitting up. He stammered, oh, well, it's always much nicer this way. She went on to have a good career starring in a popular TV series, doing small movie roles and teaching. At the height of her fame, when she was plastered on the cover of many magazines and had truly triumphed over her problems, I wondered just how huge a star she could have been if she'd never had to fight an uphill battle all the way.
Context of White Supremacy. End of our second audio segment. It was a little shorter than I thought. I was a little surprised it was all done, but that is us. We will pick up next Thursday. Clear my throat, excuse me. So we'll pick up Thursday. Section 5. I said we're still not even going to get to Sun Yi this week. Have to see. And we're, let me see. It's like, there's no chapters. It's hard to tell. I think we're maybe still not even halfway through the text yet. So whenever Sun Yi pops up, if it's next week, week or so after that, should have quite a bit of detail. I can only emphasize it may not be the most interesting right now, but man, some of the patterns and the way that he's presenting this narrative now This will be important foundation for when we get to all of that with Mia Farrow later in the book. Incidentally, before we get to the last little bit of text this week, one from the book club, James Loewen, passed away, I think, within the last 7 days. It might have been right at the end of last week. But he wrote Lies My Teachers Told Me. I said it should be Lies My White Teachers Told Me. But that's the book that's been most referenced. We read Sundown Towns, The Hidden Dimension of Racism, White Supremacy. That's the one that we read. Lots of information. In fact, they said that, I guess, Mr. Loewen knew that he was having some medical problems and might not, you know, have a long time to live. So he had been working with others to ensure that his research continued, but they didn't elaborate on what research specifically. I know from the book Sundown Towns that he has an entire catalog where he documents either regions that are still sundown towns to this day and or areas that he had not included in the book before that he now has evidence, or at least people who suspect this region could have been an official sundown town at some point. So that, I suspect, is the research that's continuing. But they didn't even want to mention that book specifically. Cal's Book Club. Second, at Alcott Beach today, again, I think I've been here the last three or four book clubs. They have lots of murals painted throughout the neighborhood as you are in West Seattle and you head down towards Alcott Beach. They have prints and some other black people. They have a mural of Dick Gregory, and I generally see it either going in or as I'm exiting Alcott Beach. And I always feel like Dick Gregory's look like, I see you, brother. I told him. You got to be careful of that, Mr. The late Dick Gregory. He was a guest on the Cows two times. Not a fan of Gus T. Renegade and the Cows, but I always pass his mural when I'm going out here. I feel like he's talking and looking at me sternly every time. The late, great Dick Gregory, also an author. Number again, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Dick Gregory would be a contemporary of Woody Allen as well. Comedian, author, their performing. I would bet they probably did some of the same shows or venues at some point. Dick Gregory, Woody at same age bracket. Anywho, we will. Let me get our investor wrote in. I didn't read all of his commentary from Mr. Allen. He continues talking about Woody Allen's voice. I think Moen Dallas also had commentary about his voice. Three, Woody Allen's reading sounds very lispy and phlegmy to me. This is possibly due to his advanced age, but adds in my mind a sinister, oh no, dirty old man quality to the audio text, given the sexual deviancy of the author. There's that word again. People keep accusing Woody Allen of being dirty. Dirty old man, even. Oh, my goodness. But Moen Dallas was talking about the sound of Woody Allen's voice as he's reading this and how that makes you feel as well. And I would even go back to the word that, or the second bit of commentary, same reader, the investor, where he says the Yiddish word that is often used to characterize Woody Allen is nebbish, which means timid. That is exactly the word that he used in the text in describing himself this week. I was stunned for a moment. I had to stop and go back like, wait, what did he just say? I'd already even, he said, I have a cardinal rule in life, never be at anyone's house guest, and I never hit on any of Hefner's housemates. The thought of any of those stacked miracles, since these are mostly white women, that's again, white women, white men are gods, goddesses, religion of white supremacy, stacked miracles, wasting a quark of their attention on one more aptly cast as a bumbler, freighted with giving the exposition, rendered me timid. As I said, if you have some sort of insecurities about your masculinity, you might feel like more of a man with a child or a very young girl. Anywho, let's see. Folks have any commentary they would like to share? Irie in Louisiana should be with us. Oh, let's see. Try it again. There we go.
Oh. I thought I did something wrong. I thought I ended up in the penalty box. I'm just kidding. I've been listening on the archives, but I wanted to call in and give my opinion about the way the book is written. I think he wrote the book in a way that a person would view a movie. Movies don't necessarily, you know, very, very rarely do they cut and say, okay, now, like, chapter one or spring, whatever, or, you know, give you segmented time of transition. I think he wants it to just flow fluidly like a movie, just nonstop. And I haven't seen a bunch of movies with him, but or by him. But let me know if I'm wrong. Doesn't he star in all his movies? Because if so, of course, he would want to star twice in his own book, once as the subject and then again as the narrator. So I think that's why he's also reading the book, too. And I want to co-sign other people's thoughts. He definitely wasn't a physical person at all. I think he was probably a nerd, but a little bit lazy of a nerd. Meaning that he was more into getting over, not necessarily doing the work that comes along with proving being smart until he got into film, obviously. And then, you know, being a suspected racist, they catapulted him, you know, further along. And I'm surprised that he's not in, you know, I thought about him as being a perfect candidate for the wisdom of a psychopath. Because it's a better way to cloak your psychopathy, which is also known as pedophilia, than to make it casual with films that are lauded as picturesque and, you know, landmark for their time and, you know, breathtaking scenery and whatnot. And I also feel like he's representational of all the people in Hollywood and people, white supremacists that have access to money that want pedophilic, if that's a word, or whatever, that want child sex, you know, interactions with children. And I wouldn't be surprised if he knew, you know, some people that have been accused of these crimes. It's just, you know, white supremacy, they're allowed to not say who did what until enough people, I guess, come out and say, yeah, he did it. But I have a feeling that he abused probably more than Dylan and Sunni, and he knows other abusers. And it's a hard book to listen to be honest with you, because of sometimes just the arrogance and then the way he espouses all the I didn't know about this one and that one and aristocracies and, you know, whatever, who else. And it's like, okay, you just get on with it. I'm sorry. He just be spouting names, like name dropping, which to me is a sign of a con artist, which is a characteristic of a psychopath. I'm sorry for rambling. Thank you. That's it. Good night, everybody.
Much obliged, Irie in Louisiana. I said the same thing about the name dropping, because he had the gall to, you know, accuse someone else of saying, oh, I just didn't like this fella. You know, he was just relentless name drop. Like, who is any worse than you at name drop this all the time? Like, oh, we were hanging out with Lyndon Johnson at the inauguration and Warren Beatty and Jackie Gleason, and I'm hanging out with Hugh Hefner talking about, we get it. We get it. You were hanging out with the Queen. We get it. We get it. What does it mean to be white? accessed all kinds, maybe even accessed very powerful white people. We get it. We get it. Ugh. Much of us, she said that she thinks that's a part of the con, all that name dropping. Let's see. Much obliged again, Ari, in Louisiana. It is, I said that, like, this week, I said it a few times as well. I agree, where she said it's hard to listen to, just, you know, it, the structure of the book. And I think that's telling, too. Maybe that's what he wanted, for this to be like a movie, because they don't have chapters on the screen in the movie. You just kind of flow seamlessly from scene to scene. Maybe that's what he wanted with this book. Maybe. But I agree. It's not. It's not Invisible Man. It's not Maya Angelou. It's not that. Where you can just enjoy listening and just really resonate with what's, you know, being read to you or narrated. Not quite that at all. Although, in my view, it does reveal a lot about what it means to be white. And I'm not a film buff. I've had to say that a few times, too. I'm not a film buff. I haven't seen very many, maybe one. I've seen very few of Mr. Allen's films. So I certainly cannot attest, but I do think he's in many of his films. I don't know if he's in all of them, but yes, many of his films. He directs them and then boop, has to pop in front of the camera as well. Let's see. Unknown from the Unknown Galaxy. Did you have commentary as well, sir? You should also be with us.
Hello, Mr. Renegade. I was just saying a few things about the book you're reading. First of all, the things other people have said, I do agree, from Mr. Maureen Dallas and to that young lady who just spoke a while ago, their insights I found refreshing. One of the reasons why I phoned tonight, Mr. Renegade, is last week he was talking about his use of girls, and you made comments about that. Now, this week, he was talking about some guy, and the guy said, girl, I'm going to see some girls. And Woody Allen says, his work, not mine. So, the link I'm making is that Woody Allen was very quick to jump on that man by using the word girls. And I'm seeing it like, well, you see, everybody used the word girls. Even he used the word girls. So I used the word girls to try and justify his use of girls. Because he emphasized his use of the word girls, the other guy. There was no need to emphasize that word. He could have just said what he said and moved on. But he had to put him up and say his words. Anyway, that's one thing. Another thing, earlier on in the first section, I wanted to speak then, because I've got a few points. But he says, I think it was, I'm not arrogant, I'm not aloof, you know. But then I carried on with that conversation in my head, and I was going to say, why doesn't he say he's not conceited? Because he might not be aloof and he might not be arrogant, but he definitely is conceited. You know, that's what I was thinking. He stopped too soon and dishonest. Yeah, why didn't he say, I'm not dishonest? Because as we know from last week, Gus, someone left the TV in his house and he did nothing to report it or where it might have come from, but was quite happy to keep it to himself. And also, Gus, in my mind, when it comes to dishonesty, his first love was dishonesty, Mr. Renegade. Magic, you know, sleight of hand. You know, how deceitful can you get when you can stand in front of somebody and make them believe one thing when actually something else has happened? And I think he's doing the same kind of thing with words, Mr. Renegade, because he has a very particular use of words, as I think everybody's realizing. He wants to be funny, and he tries to be funny. And I must admit, I've chuckled at times to the things that he said. But he doesn't have a nice thing to say about anybody. Because his wife's bedroom, he had to, you know, tell everybody how, what a bad state it was. And he only has good things to say about himself. And it makes me, I was going to use a metaphor there, you know. I feel very queasy in my stomach when I kind of understand what he's doing. And when he's talking, it's slimy. And I don't like it at all. I wish you didn't read this book. But, another quick thing I want to say. You said that you heard a bit on audio tape, like a preview of his book, of him reading. And he was talking about Sushi, I think that's the name. And you said to you said, oh, I've got to hear this. And I think that's one of the major reasons why we're reading this book. But many years ago, there was an American band, and one of the lines was, don't believe the hype. And Gus, they're still doing it today. If you don't go to the movies, Gus, but when you see an advert for a movie, the advert might be 30 seconds long. And then when you go and see the film, every good bit, everything exciting that happens in that film is in that 30-second advert. And I think they've done the same with the trailer and the book. Nothing in this book is going to be interesting. and there's that one little thing about Sushi, which people are curious about. And he's going to breeze over it. That's, you ain't going to get any detail. He's going to, she jumped on him into his arms and she professed her love to him. What else could he do? It's going to be like that. And then 20 years down the line is the next line. so that's a few things I wanted to mention there, Gus. I don't know what else to add. I'll probably think of something else save it to next week. Thank you. I hope I made myself clear.
Absolutely. Unknown from the unknown galaxy. Much obliged for your commentary, sir. Good memory, because he did say that Woody Allen, his first love being magic. That is all about deception, fooling somebody, and, you know, making them believe things that are not so. He said he thinks he could be doing the same thing with his use of words in this book. Absolutely. The snippet that I was talking about, they played like a number of little snippets from the audiobook in the documentary that aired on HBO in the spring of this year. It's called Allen vs. Pharaoh. It was not a trailer for this book. In fact, it's a series like 4 hours long that basically is saying, yeah, Woody Allen did engage in some sexual deviance with children, child rape, throughout the years. That would be the conclusion that I came to from watching it. But the snippets, they play some snippets that are just about other things, but eventually they play some of the snippets where he's talking about the relationship with Sun Yi. So I haven't read this book before, so it may be exactly what you said, where they have like, maybe let's say a paragraph or so, like in the last chapter, and that's it, and then the rest of it is just this kind of, you know, stuff. That could be, but we still not even read half of the book yet, so it might just be that we have to wade through quite a bit of malarkey in his life and things that were happening. We'll have to see. Yeah, I don't know when, even next week. It might not get to Sun Yi next week. Have to see. I think from this week we're still in the 60s, but even I can only say, even while we're reading and prep to all of that, just keep in mind some of what's been said so far, especially the way that he talks about girls, females, all of that, not women, girls, and then who is initiating, who's bringing up the ideas for this, who's the one that's kind of egging it on, like, yeah, we should be doing this, we should be doing something sexual. That's, keep all of that in mind when we get to the section on Sun Yi. I'm like, I could have flipped ahead. It's like, when are we going to get to this? Is this coming next week or whatever? I could have, but I'll be surprised. So I'll just, you know, find out with the rest of you all. But, woo. even more excited after what we heard this week. Let's see.
A quick question, Mr. Renegade.
Yes, sir.
In your 13 years, I think it's for 10 years of being on Black Talk Radio, have you ever, or the book club, have you ever not finished the book before?
Oh, no. We don't do that. We don't do that. I don't care how bad the book is. Like, this is not like people know me. Like, I'm normally very honest. If I am not feeling a book and it's getting on my nerves, like me having to go through it, I will just say that. I said that for Nutricide. Oh, worst book ever. I said that repeatedly, almost from the very first week that we read the book. I said that for The Hate U Give. Like, it's Wretched of the Earth. It's been a whole lot of books that I was, oh my God, this is the worst. It's killing me. This is not in that category. Not at all. Like, it's not, I've said that a few times too. It's not in my favorite book category yet, but like, oh yeah, I have way too many highlights, and I keep saying we haven't even hit the good part yet, man. Like, it's long-winded and all this other stuff, but even some of what you all have said, like some of this long-windedness, it seems purposeful. It seems like it's part of, could be part of a greater deception. Go ahead.
It's my manipulation. Mm-hmm. That's the way I see it. And I think he's also writing this book to keep him out of jail. You know, this book is for the judge. I think, you see, judge there and there and there. I'm innocent. That's it.
This is for the judge. This book, I said that earlier today, this book was published in 2020. Very recent. This is a big, connected, wealthy, powerful white man with, and he's already bragged about, he's did all this name dropping. So he's got like 50, 60, what is that, 60? It's about 70 at this point, 70 years worth of connections to other powerful white people all over the world. I'm sure he knew, oh, this documentary is coming. They've been talking about this for some years. They keep bringing this back up now. Like, ooh, tide might be turning. Better, you know, do something to manipulate some of these opinions. I think they did an interview where he's like, oh, man, they got my man Bill Cosby. Like, ooh. Could have said, hey, let me get to using these words. Do an old magic trick to persuade some folks. Let them know Woody.
Mr. Renegade.
Still a good guy. Yes, sir.
One last thing. Can you imagine somebody of Mr. Allen's reputation to go to Mr. Heffner's mansion, yeah, and not stress out any of the ladies in there? Never. And don't forget, he's very deceitful. That's what I need to say.
Hey, my man Bill Clinton said that he didn't inhale. So you have some individuals who are classified as white. They got morals, you know. They got standards for behavior, you know. They don't just go out and do it just because I'm at the mansion. That doesn't mean that I'm going to be feeling and groping on everybody. Just because I got the joint in my lips, that doesn't mean that you inhale. Come on. Use what Woody Allen, he said. He said in the opening, he said, use logic, man. Use logic. What do I look like going up here, 57 years old? Got a divorce proceeding going on, and I'm going to come up here and rape some children. Use logic, man. Come on.
Well, I'm using logic about who left his mansion, and I say he's guilty of troubling them ladies.
Just trying to use logic, folks. Just saying. If it means something to you to go to Hugh Hefner's mansion, maybe you can still do that. Why go if you don't want to play with anything? I mean, you could have stayed and got a magazine and called it a day. Like, why go? Woo! System of White Supremacy. Again, that was Unknown from the Unknown Galaxy. Much obliged, good sir. We also heard Irie in there as well, Mo in Dallas. Just quickly go through a few of my notes and then double check, make sure everybody's satisfied or anything else they need to share. When he starts off this section, he says he references himself as an ignoramus for not making these changes. This is a part of that manipulation where you can write a book where every other paragraph, I'm an idiot, I'm a klutz, I'm stupid, I'm an ignoramus, just on and on and on. And all right, you're the dumbest white person ever. We got it. In part, anytime a white person is really overly emphasizing how dumb and stupid they are, beware. Next, he says, the metaphor, man, what is that idiot who talks about no metaphors for the compensatory call-in? Page or so over, he says, rehearsals began and there was much mutual masturbation with everyone laughing uproariously at everyone else's lines and behavior. I've heard this metaphor used from time to time. My suspicion is that it is going to fall out of use with all of the allegations of sexual misconduct and what have you. Like, I don't know if I want to be too careless about using this metaphor, and particularly someone who's facing allegations of sexual misconduct. And I, one of the other things with metaphors, generally you use a metaphor to make a comparison when there's one topic or subject that you are not familiar with. You want to take a subject that you are very familiar with that you can relate it to. Got to be something that we are more familiar with, relatable to, than mutual masturbation from someone accused of child molestation. Let's see. The segment that unknown from unknown, unknown from the unknown galaxy mentioned, he said, I meant, Alan writes, I spent the Sunday afternoons in Philly with David Merrick. He had been a lawyer who went into the theater to meet girls. His words. Now, I don't know if that's a little bit of, maybe that's not something that one wants to brag about. This is why that I wanted to go to the theaters, just to pick up girls. Or if it's what I said last week, hey, why isn't it I wanted to go to the theater to pick up ladies? Women. Am I to take you at your word? Girls. Teens. 14. Lots of that rife in the culture, white culture, system of white supremacy. Let's see. He talks about one of his earlier plays that he wrote. He said, a very nice thing to hear under the duress of weak notices. In time, I would give him a next play, a better one, though still no great shakes. Play it again, Sam. Now, again, Fuller's Films, he talks about Casablanca all the time, as do many folks. That's, you know, Hollywood royalty in terms of films. Sam is the character of the black male who plays the piano. Ooh-wee, I hadn't even thought about it. We just talked about the obsession, the homoerotic obsession with black males, particularly black jazz entertainers. So Sam is playing the piano. That's the famous line from Casablanca. Play it again, Sam. All the black people used to go crazy because that's one of the, this is a really old film, like almost 100 years old. And they didn't have too many black characters at the time. You didn't have Denzel Washington and Michael B. Jordan on every frame at that time. So black people would get up and go crazy when this played in the theater. And Sam would be on the screen playing the piano. But for Woody Allen, this is one of your first plays that you write. Play it again, Sam. Same thing. Fixation, black male musicians in particular, but that fixation on them. I would even be interested in reading or seeing this. Like, what is it about exactly? Let's see. And the lying, he says, to beef up the page. So he got bad reviews. People said, ah, this place sucks. So to beef up the page, I used my mother in amongst many legit quotes, and it was high praise from Nettie Konigsberg indeed. Now, again, this is the same thing that they talk about in Varsity Blues, the season with the college admission scandal. Anything. My parents hop in. What do you need? Fake resume letter? What do you need? Fake reference? We got it. Come on, let's do it. They go and get the camera and make up all kinds of things, and then they come back and talk about meritocracy. Come on, man. Then, now he beefed up the page, right? You come down one paragraph and he said, I ate ribs with my friends John and Jean Dumanian. In those days, Chicago had a joint called the Black Angus that had ribs that taste of which gave life meaning you couldn't get from religion, psychoanalysis, or great art. Dr. Welsing Moment, someone who has over and over again talked about his insecurities as a man, and he has an obsession with eating Black Angus ribs. That's right, up Dr. Welsing has all that in the ISIS papers about the consumption of coffee and hamburgers, steaks, and all of that. What is that about? What is that for? Insecurity, white genetic annihilation, particularly white manly insecurities. Next. Playboy Mansion, we talked about not going on that one. The Quaaludes, Bill Cosby, where he says things were going quite poorly in my marriage as Louise had discovered what is today called weed. That is, then it was called grass. In the distant past, it was called muggles. Satan also weighed in with uppers, amyl nitrate, quaaludes, and a cluster of new positions to try out with any male registered to vote in the tri-state area. Again, the sexual deviance is being projected onto the female. And the quit, now that's Bill Cosby all the way. And there were a number of folks who said, hey, this was the beatnik era, excuse me. This was Students for Democratic Society, the hippies, and everything that's happened in the 1960s. That's the late 1960s. All of that drugs and LSD, and I mean, like really do some brain damage. Drugs, heroin, and all the rest of it. Quaaludes, they talked about, oh, this was all the sexual revolution and going out. Yeah, I'm going to experiment with some drugs and some sex. Maybe have sex with some niggers. People who said, I don't think Bill Cosby did any raping. I think this was the environment. You had a whole lot of, especially in this circle, who, hey, let's do some drugs and mess around and then try out some positions and all that. And then end up having some people who, oh, now I feel some type of way about this. Yeah, I don't agree with that. Anywho, white people in drug use is rampant throughout the system of white supremacy and all this deviant sex. And then he gives the observation when he's in the prison, and he talks about how it's so-called segregated. He sees all the white people on one side and the black people on the other side. Typical. Yeah. Are you surprised about that? It's done. He comes back and he says, that he quipped that he could have seen the same thing in any cafeteria or whatever the case may be. I have always talked about system of racism, white supremacy. It is not about white people and black people sitting apart or sitting together or being separated in prison or anywhere else. It is about a power dynamic. Sometimes the white people want to be sitting right next to you. He said he did a show with Nina Simone. Sometimes that's what they want. Sometimes they want you to be on the other side of the plantation. It just depends on how racists want to operate the plantation. But just if all the inmates had been together in the same cell, would have made no difference. If all the folks in the cafeteria sitting at the same table, makes no difference. We're still in a system of racism, white supremacy. Those superficialities are symptoms of the problem. I'll stop there. Any other folks' comments that they want to make sure they get in before we wrap up? San Quentin is crazy. We just read San Quentin for Geronimo Pratt's book. We just keep coming back to saying that's where Charles Manson was, had the late, should I say, late great Charles Manson, San Quentin. Folks satisfied? Everybody good? Grand. We'll be here tomorrow for Neutralizing Workplace Racism, and Saturday, compensatory call-in, try to catch up, make sense of what has happened over the past week. Again, we are at kind of halfway point, maybe not even quite halfway, so we have a ways to go in the text. Hopefully it will be constructive. We'll learn some things. Much obliged for everyone's participation. Hopefully it has been worthy of your time and energy, particularly given what we just heard. Man, sobriety would be best. We don't need any quaaludes, weeds, muggles. Like, woof. Let's stay sober. In addition to being sober, if you're going to go out and about, be very alert. Man, it's been so many incidents of just random, unprovoked violence and chaos. Gotta be very mindful about what's happening around you. If you don't leave your residence with a plan to kill and or die, if you see someone being hostile and loud in public, exit. You do not want to make an error and find out, oh, this person is armed, and or, oh, this person is armed and they have an entire armed entourage. Very common. Lots of armed psychopaths. I had that book mentioned, Kevin Dutton, Wisdom of Psychopaths. All of that said, if you do go out and you're driving, you're not on the cell phone, doing the small things that we can to minimize contact with race soldiers, and we need all of our attention. All of that said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Shut I'm up. A victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.